What is up, everyone? Welcome to another episode of the AFC East Brothers Podcast with Kyle and Gary. Just Kyle here today, bringing you an in-depth look at Christian Hackenberg, the much maligned prospect, the very famous second-round draft pick of the New York Jets, or maybe the very infamous second-round draft pick of the New York Jets. People have been all over the map with this guy. Some, such as the famous John Gruden, would say, first-round talent. Anyone that passes up on him in the first round is a fool. And then you have people on the opposite side of the spectrum say, this guy doesn't even deserve to be drafted, such as Sam Monson of Pro Football Focus. And you know, typically when people ask you, would you like to hear the bad news or the good news first? I got some good news and some bad news for you. Which would you like first? Most often, I think people say bad news first. Let's just get it out of the way, and then I'll have the good stuff at the end. We can end on a good, on a high note, right? That's how people think. So let's start off with some bad about Hackenberg, and let's go right to Mr. Sam Monson and what he says and thinks about Christian Hackenberg. All right, so he wrote a piece in which he said, Christian Hackenberg doesn't even deserve a draftable grade. And he gives several key points. He uses some GIF images in the process. He uses some analytics. Obviously, Pro Football Focus is an analytics-based site to justify his reasoning. And I'll talk about some other points that he made later on in this podcast, but let's start off first with decision-making. Okay? And in that piece, he says that PFF's play-by-play grading scale works from a minus 2 to a plus 2 in 0.5 increments. Minus 1.5 and minus 2 throws are catastrophic plays that usually result in a turnover. Hackenberg had 37 of them over his college career, equivalent to a catastrophically bad pass on 3.1% of his attempts. Okay? Now, Jared Goff, by contrast, threw one on 1.1% in 2015 of his attempts. Even Michigan State quarterback Connor Cook, whom we have noted throughout his draft evaluation for his bad habit of reckless throws, threw one on 1.5% or less than half the rate of Hackenberg. So let's just think about that for a second. Hackenberg is basically throwing 3 times the amount of catastrophic passes as Jared Goff, and more than double that of Connor Cook, who is also reckless with the ball. So in PFF's mind, this guy is making catastrophically bad throws all the time. Then they have a GIF image of him throwing a screen pass right to an Indiana defender that takes it to the house. And we've actually seen this several times throughout Christian Hackenberg's career that this has happened. This kind of reminds you of something that Mark Sanchez would do. And then Monson says that, you know, Hackenberg regularly does not see defenders breaking on the ball or cutting underneath the intended receiver, etc., etc. So, Christian Hackenberg, in PFF's mind, catastrophically dangerous throws time in, time again. And just think about that for a second. The NFL for years, philosophies have changed in the NFL. Whether you should be a run-dominant offense or a pass-dominant offense, those have changed throughout the years. All right, the league has moved from a running league to a passing league. One thing that has been a constant with the game is turnovers decide ball games. And typically we see that teams that are very turnover-heavy, but force a lot of turnovers, typically those are a good team. Conversely, teams that are really bad, give up a lot of turnovers, they're usually a really bad team. And teams that are very good in the turnover margin, force many more turnovers than they give up, they're usually a pretty good team. We've seen this many, many times. The examples are so numerous to name. But if you have a quarterback that's constantly turning over the ball, that's bad news. And Jets fans, we know this. We've seen this with Geno Smith. We've seen this with Mark Sanchez. Two very turnover-prone quarterbacks, right? Despite having limited pass attempts, they both threw over 20 interceptions in their rookie year. Mark Sanchez tossed 20 in comparison to 12 interceptions, and Geno Smith tossed 12 touchdowns in comparison to 21 interceptions, not to mention that both were heavy fumblers. So, is it more of the same with Christian Hackenberg? PFF, Sam Monson, would seem to indicate that yes, that is the case. All right, so next, we're going to talk about Mr. Jordan Palmer, the younger brother of Carson Palmer, the quarterback of the Arizona Cardinals, formerly of the Oakland Raiders and the Cincinnati Bengals. Now, Carson Palmer was a very good quarterback and still is. You know, we just mentioned Pro Football Focus. They had him as their number one quarterback for the majority of the season, and it wasn't until that late season collapse that they slightly knocked him down a little bit. But he's having the best years of his career right now out in Arizona with Bruce Arians. Jordan Palmer, on the other hand, the smaller, the younger brother, not the same stature, maybe has a similar football mind to that of Carson Palmer, but not the physical tools to that of his older brother. Now, with that being said, even though he had these inferior skills, he was still able to stick around as a backup quarterback for several years in the league. In fact, he backed up his brother for several years. So, one thing, you can't totally knock the guy and say that he's an incompetent boob of a quarterback that doesn't know anything. That's not the case with him. He at least has some kind of football smarts. Now, he's taken those football smarts that he's had, and he's turned it into a business. He's now a QB mentor, a QB guru, if you will. He trains quarterbacks. And he is most known for training Blake Bortles a couple years ago. More of that to come in a little bit. But I want to go ahead and play a sound clip of Jordan Palmer in an interview that was done with Ross Tucker and someone else. Cannot think of the guy's name off the top of my head. Now, Jordan Palmer, he went and he said the same type of rhetoric right after Christian Hackenberg's pro day. So, in my mind, that he's saying these same exact lines, this tells you that this is something predetermined in his head, that this is a point that whenever he speaks to the media, he wants to make sure that he hits this point across. Let's go ahead and play the clip.
When he came out of high school as an 18-year-old, you know, this kid just turned 21 a couple weeks ago. When he came out of high school, he came into a huge situation, absolute turmoil. You know better than I do, Ross, what was going on at Penn State. And he was asked to do a lot as an 18-year-old. And so when Bill O'Brien had time with him, it was all about getting him caught up on the system, how to run it. So you don't have a whole lot of time to work mechanics. So his freshman year, he was just playing. And then a new staff comes in, and like as you referenced, some personnel issues up front. You know, we lost Allen Robinson, and there wasn't a ton of answers from my perspective. Again, not a Nittany Lion fan, just watching tape, not a lot of answers. You know, you're a college student and you have so much stuff going on. You have school, you have friends, you have practice, you have training table, you have all these things. And so such a small sliver of that pie that is your day is mechanics. And what I saw for 2 years is when Christian was able to go into a meeting room and talk football and try and get better, the majority of that time was spent trying to find answers at how we're going to block and how we're going to get open. And such little time was spent, and this is not an indictment on his coaching staff, such a little time was spent on Christian specifically that for 3 years he just went and played. And I just don't know that many guys who are good enough to just go out and ball for 3 years when the majority of their workload is trying to figure out how we're going to block this, how we're going to get open, what we're going to do versus this look, which is why, you know, I wanted to work with him. I wanted to help him because when he gets to the NFL and he gets on a staff that can, where he has that sliver of the pie is much bigger, where he can focus on himself. This is one of those kids where the sky is the absolute limit.
Yeah, I have to be honest. I'm not buying what Jordan Palmer is selling, and here's why. You know, if you go back and you go on YouTube, type in Jordan Palmer, Hackenberg Mechanics, you'll find a video of him speaking right after the combine. And basically Palmer's saying, you know, well, I think he had a great day and he hit, you know, almost all these throws and he did so many different play action angles and stuff. And he's kind of very, you know, politically correct, and you know he's not trying to be too boisterous or anything like that. But once he starts spouting off this type of stuff about improving his mechanics, and this small sliver of a pie is devoted to mechanics when you're a college student because you're doing this and that, you have classes, you have film, you have all this other stuff. You're being so busy when you're a college student, so very little gets focused on you and mechanics. You know, he starts to brighten his smile up and his demeanor. But here's the thing about this is, yes, I do think that Jordan Palmer genuinely believes that he has improved Christian Hackenberg's mechanics. But to what extent would I really ask? And Jordan Palmer says this. He says no college quarterbacks have so much time to focus on mechanics. Well, here's the thing. Weren't they, on average, better mechanically speaking than Hackenberg? Right? Hackenberg, at certain points throughout his career, his mechanics were so flawed. They were so bad. Right? Now, if every college quarterback struggles with mechanics because they don't have the time to put it in and to work at that, well, doesn't that say something about Hackenberg then? Because it's not like, you know, Hackenberg was the only college quarterback and you're comparing him against pros. Compare him to other college-ready quarterbacks. What were their mechanics like versus his? So I'm not really buying that. Here's another reason why I'm not buying it. Is because of this. He says in that interview with Ross Tucker that because Christian was doing so many different things in college, right? Classes, this, that, only a little sliver of that pie gets devoted to mechanics. And also this, he was so busy worrying about what protections, because, and he cites the fact that they had a lot of young guys. And it's very common knowledge that Penn State had converted defensive linemen that were converted to offensive linemen. So no doubt Penn State had a bunch of young players and things like that. I get that. So he says, because they had so many young players, Christian was constantly worried about studying the film room and what protections he was going to call on and worrying about how they were going to block up this certain scheme and how this receiver was going to run this certain route and what they needed to do on that play. He spent so much time worrying about that. Here's the big flaw, if that's what you're going to say. The big flaw in that is that, okay, well, explain then the fact that once Christian Hackenberg had all these young offensive linemen, that wasn't in his first year. His first year with O'Brien, he had a veteran offensive line. It didn't come until his 2014 and 2015 season once the sanctions started to rein in. And once Christian Hackenberg had those young offensive linemen, what happened? James Franklin is the head coach. Well, James Franklin is that same coach that took away Hackenberg's audible ability. He made much less calls at the line of scrimmage than he did even as a freshman. He had much more control over what protection he was going to call out, etc., etc. So if you're going to say that Hackenberg was spending so much time worrying about the protection scheme and the game plan that he couldn't focus on his mechanics, well, that doesn't exactly add up, because he had a lot more time to focus on that stuff. And he had a lot more ability to do that stuff his freshman year. So I disagree with Jordan Palmer's logic completely. Now we're going to move on and we're going to talk about Blake Bortles. Blake Bortles is the one big client that Jordan Palmer is known for grooming. He is one reason why Jets fans are optimistic about Christian Hackenberg. Hey, well, look what Jordan Palmer did for Blake Bortles, after all. Blake Bortles went to a small school, UCF, not great talent around him, big question marks about him coming out of the draft. But Jordan Palmer fixed up his mechanics, made him fly up the draft boards, and the Jacksonville Jaguars took him third overall. And it didn't stop there. He could have been a bust like other top 10 Jacksonville Jaguars picks, such as Blaine Gabbert. But no, he wasn't a bust. Right? Everyone talks about Blake Bortles was that quarterback that came in second touchdown passes to that of Tom Brady last year. This guy was a fantasy stud last year, Blake Bortles. Went undrafted in most leagues, probably every league that I can think of. And he was a great free agency pickup. I know someone that drafted Joe Flacco in, like, I don't know what round. And Joe Flacco was just terrible for him. And then he ended up scooping Blake Bortles up, and it ended up really helping out his fantasy season. But you know what, ladies and gentlemen? I don't think Blake Bortles is all that good. And I'm not the only one that doesn't think Blake Bortles is all that good. I get it. A lot of people are on the Blake Bortles hype wagon. Third overall pick, right? Nice kid. He's rebuilding that Jacksonville Jaguars, you know, franchise. They've made all these other moves this offseason. There's so much reason to be optimistic out in Jacksonville. Again, not buying it. I saw this kid play in MetLife Stadium this past year, and I was really down on him. This was midseason. I was really down on him before I walked in the game. I saw how Bortles stinks. I was heckling fans that were wearing Bortles jerseys. And why would I do that? I truly believe the kid is garbage, that he's not that good, that he's overrated. Now, he continued throwing touchdown passes throughout the rest of the season. I get that. But I think when you look at his statistics and you comb through his numbers in more detail, you find out that Bortles isn't actually all that good. Now, one of the social media quarterback gurus out there that does a lot of work with quarterbacks, and you owe it to yourself to look into this, pre-snap reads quarterback catalog. So much detail is put into there. The author's name is Sian Fahey. He writes out of Ireland, writes for the NFL, writes for a couple outlets, his website, presnapreads.com, as well as Football Outsiders, amongst others. It's a $9.99 book. You can buy it. PDF will be delivered right to you. Tremendous, tremendous in-depth analysis on the top 35 passers from last season. I'm going to read to you a little snippet about what he wrote about Blake Bortles. Bortles' accuracy is clearly at an unacceptable level. The main reason for the lack of efficiency isn't physical ability. It's a lack of technical refinement. Bortles doesn't throw the ball the same way all the time. He doesn't consistently set his feet and maintain his balance. Mechanics are often a misunderstood but very important aspect of being an NFL quarterback. It's why even veteran quarterbacks such as Tom Brady put an emphasis on refining and maintaining mechanical consistency during every offseason. If you're falling backwards or leading too far forwards when you release the ball, chances are it will float off target or arrive short of the intended receiver. This is what happened with Bortles throughout the year. Furthermore, he has an elongated throwing motion. His hand drops to his waist or too far behind his head before he releases the ball. That exposes him to more fumbles. He had 14 in 2015, and it makes it tougher to throw from tight pockets. Again, that is from the pre-snap reads QB catalog. Now, again, for every quarterback, there is a chart of passes that they were accurate on and passes that they were inaccurate on. That doesn't mean completions, right? You can be accurate with a pass and a receiver can drop it, or there could be tight coverage. So just because you're accurate on a pass doesn't necessarily mean it's a completion. And just because you throw an incompletion doesn't mean you were inaccurate with a pass. So honestly, you know, completion percentage, you know, whether you're accurate on a pass or not is probably a better gauge of how well the quarterback played than completion percentage, because a lot of that can be on how good the receivers are and how good the defenses are that you were going against. One thing you can't account for is strength of schedule, right? One of the reasons why the Jets went 10-6 last year is because they had a poor strength of schedule. So he has this graph of the football field and has a bunch of different green dots for the accurate passes and a bunch of different red dots for the inaccurate passes. And Blake Bortles was actually one of the most inaccurate quarterbacks in the entire league. He ranked, I believe it was 30th in that regard. Also, Blake Bortles had an interceptable pass rate of 20.2, which ranked 30th. Blake Bortles had 30 interceptable passes. 30. That is the same amount as Ryan Fitzpatrick. And any Jets fan should know that every time Ryan Fitzpatrick dropped back, you were scared. And I get it, it's not all because of his, you know, his mental ability. Like with Geno Smith, you were scared because mentally he was going to make a brain fart and throw an interception. Fitzpatrick, you more so questioned that he's such a daring gunslinger that, you know, he has a better belief in what his arm talent is than what it really is. But anyway, Blake Bortles, 30 interceptable passes. Now, what does interceptable mean? That means that the pass could have very well been intercepted, but it wasn't. And in the preview for Sian Fahey's book, The QB Catalog, which I'm talking about right now, he talks about one of the most crazy passes or one of the most crazy plays in the 2015 NFL season, which was when Marcus Mariota was playing the Saints. He drops back, he throws the ball. Two Saints defenders are right there. Both of them have a shot at intercepting the ball. What happens? The two Saints players collide within one another. The ball bounces in the air. Delanie Walker scoops it up, runs in the end zone for a touchdown. Now, think about that for a second. That play should have been an interception. Instead, it's a touchdown. It counts as a positive for Marcus Mariota in terms of fantasy stats and how he's perceived by anyone looking at a box score. But however, if you know and you watch the game, that's actually a knock on Marcus Mariota. That's a bad thing. So interceptable passes means that it's a pass that didn't necessarily go down as an interception. It could have been, but it could have been intercepted. Blake Bortles was right at the top of the league, tied with Ryan Fitzpatrick in this regard. Why would Sian Fahey say that he was at the top of the league in terms of interceptable passes? Poor mechanics. Doesn't throw the same consistently on a consistent basis. That is alarming. All right? So, again, Blake Bortles, inaccuracy, right at the bottom of the league. Interceptable passes, right at the bottom of the league. Why? Poor mechanics. If Jordan Palmer was so good and he fixed Blake Bortles and he made Blake Bortles into this going to be elite quarterback, then is he going to do it for the same thing for Christian Hackenberg? I don't think so. Again, what my eyes tell me in the couple games that I watched the Bortles was never impressed. I go out and I now have these statistics to back it up. I even have a less of optimism about Mr. Bortles. So, am I convinced that Jordan Palmer has fixed Blake Bortles' mechanics? No. Am I convinced that he's fixed Christian Hackenberg's mechanics? No, I'm not. Further clarification on Mr. Bortles. So you may be asking yourself, okay, well, 35 touchdowns didn't just come from nowhere. He has to be at least decent for him to get those types of statistics. And I would say he's probably below average. You know, certainly has some traits that you'd like to see, but I'm not at all sold on him. And the reason why he had such good statistics, listen, I am one of the biggest Ryan Fitzpatrick haters ever. I'm a Jets fan. Ryan Fitzpatrick led us to 10 wins last season. We hadn't had a winning season since 2010, about a half a decade, right? He came in through 31 touchdowns, a franchise record. Yet, I still don't like the guy. Quite honestly, I could care less if he's in a Jets uniform this season. Okay? But I know why he had 31 touchdowns. He was thrown to good receivers. He was around a good scheme. Same thing with Bortles. You could argue that last season, what was the best wide receiver tandem in the league? Many people would either say the Jacksonville Jaguars or the New York Jets. Brandon Marshall and Eric Decker or Allen Robinson and Allen Hurns. And in Sian Fahey's book, he calls Allen Hurns and Allen Robinson pterodactyls. Not that they're these huge body type guys. They're certainly big, 6'3", the both of them. You know, well over 210 pounds, the both of them. But he says that they're like pterodactyls, which is the famous flying dinosaur that we've seen in movies such as Jurassic Park, that they can contort their body in midair and adjust to a pass, even if it's inaccurate. And again, as I said before, Blake Bortles, one of the most inaccurate quarterbacks. And clarification, I went back and looked at those statistics, and out of the 35 quarterbacks that were charted, only four of them ranked below Blake Bortles in terms of accuracy. Those were Nick Foles, Brian Hoyer, Ryan Fitzpatrick, and Jameis Winston. To me, two of these are no surprise at all. Nick Foles, that's not a surprise at all. You knew that he was way overrated. Actually, three of them. Brian Hoyer, we all know he sucks. Ryan Fitzpatrick, again, I just went on a whole rant about him. Jameis Winston is the one surprise to me. But again, I didn't even watch the guy's games closely. I can't even think if I watched a single Tampa Bay game in full. And I really like Jameis Winston coming out. So that is a bit surprising to me. But Blake Bortles, again, extremely inaccurate. Now, when you have good wide receivers that can bail you out, and this is what happened all the time with Ryan Fitzpatrick last year. Think back to the New England game. Ryan, and I went to this game week 16. Ryan Fitzpatrick just throws up a prayer in the end zone. That pass is over the opposite side of Marshall's shoulder. He throws it to the wrong shoulder. And not only is Marshall covered, he's double covered, but he throws it right to the safety. If the safety had any idea what he was doing, he would have picked that ball off. And not only that, but Brandon Marshall makes it a phenomenal adjustment to the ball while it's in midair, catches it, and goes for a touchdown. That pass, instead of going for a 30-plus yard touchdown downfield, could have very well been a pick. But again, interceptable passes. Blake Bortles, time and time again, Brandon Marshall bailed out Ryan Fitzpatrick. Same thing with Eric Decker. The same thing was happening down in Jacksonville with Blake Bortles. So again, I'll stress that one more time. Why was Blake Bortles so inaccurate? Poor mechanics. Not that he can't throw it. Not that he doesn't have a strong arm. Not that he's not athletically gifted. He is all those things. But poor mechanics on a consistent basis. And one of the things that Jordan Palmer talked about is doing these things over and over and over. Mechanics over and over and over. So it becomes muscle memory and that you're used to it. But again, did Palmer really fix Blake Bortles? If he did, surely we wouldn't see these problems ensuing. But we've seen 2 years of Bortles now, and it's more of the same. All right, so now we're going to talk about the content of Mr. Christian Hackenberg's character. And why is this important? It's important because the quarterback is supposed to be the leader of the team. He's supposed to be the role model. Right, when you think of an NFL franchise, right, who's supposed to be the face of it? It's the quarterback, right? And just think about the fact that, you know, those of us that are listening to football podcasts in July during the peak of the dead time of the off season, when nothing's going on, no draft coverage, no free agency, etc. We're the diehards. We're the people that know pretty much the 53-man roster. We could name 40-something players on our teams easily. But we have to understand that there are people in the fan base that only know a handful of players on the team. And you best believe that one of those people that they probably know is the quarterback. And you should want the quarterback to be a natural leader. Someone that is going to fire other guys up. Someone that is going to lead by example. So the hope is that Christian Hackenberg can be that guy. Now, he's been in the news for a whole bunch of reasons. Some say he's a great leader. He's a great kid. Others say not so much. I'm going to read a quote from a piece that Robert Klemko of the MMQB, the sportsillustrated.com website. This is what he said. Whether or not Hackenberg blamed the coaching staff. And he said in a little blurb, never blame the coach. Per two personnel sources on two separate teams who have shown interest in drafting Penn State's Christian Hackenberg, the quarterback has said all the wrong things in interviews when asked to explain his declining sophomore and junior numbers. A combined 28 touchdowns to 21 interceptions. Hackenberg has shifted blame to coach James Franklin, who took over in 2014 when coach Bill O'Brien departed for the Texans. Said one evaluator, despite the fact that it's probably true, you don't want to hear a kid say that. End quote. Now, again, this is anonymous sources. This is not stuff that you can go fact check yourself and go look up at a clip of the words actually coming out of Christian Hackenberg's mouth. You cannot go and see that. So when was this information acquired? Well, it was probably done via some type of private team interview at the combine or what have you. And we are not privy to that information. We don't have that information. So you have to take that with a grain of salt. Okay? Because again, it's not something that we can fact check. Now, let's think of it like this. Okay, so Christian Hackenberg, he goes down with a shoulder injury in his very last game, the Tax Slayer Bowl. And as a young kid, you could imagine how upset he is. Very last collegiate game, wears on his shoulders, he wants to go out with a bang, and he can't finish that last game. Now, Christian Hackenberg was criticized deeply because of this. And if you see him in that post-game press conference, he's got his hat drooped over his face. You can barely see his eyes. You could say maybe poor body language. Shoulders are kind of hunched over. And what does he do in this post-game press conference? He declares for the NFL draft. And in doing so, he said he wants to thank a whole bunch of people. And he lists about six people explicitly. The very first person that he named was Coach Bill O'Brien. Now, the first things first is Christian Hackenberg loves Bill O'Brien, for better or for worse. He's the reason why Christian chose to go to Penn State. Christian Hackenberg could have pretty much went anywhere. He could have went to Alabama with Coach Nick Saban, who is one at that point when Christian Hackenberg was still committing to colleges. What did he win, 4 or 5 national championships with Alabama by that point? He could have went there and been the quarterback for the Crimson Tide, which, if you want to talk about talent coming from a Crimson Tide quarterback, the most talented quarterback to come out in a very, very long time. He could have went there, but he chose to go to Penn State. Why? Because he saw that pro-style fit. Him and Coach Bill O'Brien, they got along. He saw it as a natural fit. So that's the first person that he thanked. I don't have a problem with that. I really don't. Then he goes and lists about 5 other people. But who was one of those people that he didn't name? He didn't name Coach James Franklin. The interesting thing about that is that James Franklin was the coach in 2014 and 2015. Hackenberg had James Franklin for twice the amount of time that he had for Bill O'Brien. And you might ask yourself, he thanks Bill O'Brien. And not only did he have him for twice the amount of length, but he had him more recently. Bill O'Brien hasn't been his coach in 2.5+ years. But he still goes and thanks him first. Now you might ask yourself, all right, well, did Christian really try to do this on purpose? Did he really just try to stick it to Coach James Franklin and really express his displeasure for him? I don't think that he did. I think the kid was honestly just distraught, and I think his subconscious played into this. I really do. I say this because there's no doubt that Christian Hackenberg has more respect for Coach Bill O'Brien. There's no doubt that he likes him more. But that doesn't mean that he explicitly tried to forget Coach James Franklin. I think his subconscious just played on it. He wanted to think of all the people that, you know, he felt really helped develop him. And Coach Bill O'Brien was one such person. Now, it begs the question, well, was Hackenberg prompted afterwards to then go out and publicly apologize and then go and thank Coach James Franklin? And I think he did. I definitely think he did, because this is not something that he initially did. He went out and thanked someone afterwards. And we see this all the time. News just came out that, you know, Isaiah Crowell just posted some type of crazy image of someone slitting a police officer's throat or something like that. And I think he went out and apologized after that. And again, is that apology sincerely coming from Isaiah Crowell? No one really knows. But you best believe that some people in his camp, some people close to him, are saying, listen, bro, what are you doing? Go and apologize for what you've done. So, there's no doubt that Hackenberg had more respect for O'Brien. But I don't necessarily view it as him throwing Coach Franklin under the bus. A man can have the feelings that he wants. The problem becomes when you publicly go out and express your displeasure to someone explicitly. Hackenberg didn't do this. So honestly, I don't knock him for that. I have no problem with what he did. He's a kid. He's got a bad shoulder injury. He couldn't finish his last college game. He's clearly upset. He's going to thank the people that mean the most to him. And he didn't explicitly throw anyone under the bus. Not that we can physically actually appoint to. And take it for what it's worth, but Christian Hackenberg, he stayed with Penn State. You know, in a day and age in college football when people are transferring colleges all the time, Cam Newton, the Heisman Trophy winner, the national champion, the Super Bowl participant, the NFL MVP, Cam Newton. Once upon a time, he was a Florida Gator. He transferred schools. Baker Mayfield, the quarterback of the Oklahoma Sooners. He took the Sooners to the college football playoff this past year. He used to be a Texas Tech Red Raider. Quarterbacks change schools quite frequently. Christian Hackenberg committed to Penn State, despite the fact that all these sanctions were going on, despite the fact that he knew they were going to have less scholarships coming in, despite the fact that he knew he was going to have lesser talent around him. He could have still transferred. He probably still could have went to Alabama. Yet he chose not to, even though he knew the coaching change was going to be different. So to say that he's got bad character, or to say that he's not a team player, I don't know that I necessarily buy that. Let's go into a little bit more depth. Let's look at Hackenberg during the good 2013 days, when he did have Bill O'Brien as his head coach. All right, so this is taken from a piece of that someone named Lars Anderson of Bleacher Report wrote. And he narrates a story to us of Christian Hackenberg being this young, confident 18-year-old on campus, in the dorm rooms on football Sundays after the college football Saturday has already taken place. Now they're resting up before they're about to prepare for another grinding week of practice. He's sitting with his teammates in the dorm room. Christian Hackenberg says, quote, he's checking to a sluggo seam. He's calling a draw. He's throwing a slant. What is Christian Hackenberg talking about? He's calling out what Tom Brady is doing, what calls he's making at the line of scrimmage. Christian Hackenberg, I don't know that he's actually explicitly said this, but the piece implies that he's a Penn State fan, not a Penn State fan, a New England Patriots fan. The logic seems to be there. They're a good team. Tom Brady is one of the all-time greats. Bill O'Brien used to be his former offensive coordinator. And Christian Hackenberg has said, and Bill O'Brien has said, that the offense is pretty much what New England ran. Penn State's offense is what New England ran. So he's trying to predict what Tom Brady's doing, and he's getting a rise out of this. He wants to show his teammates. And at first, the piece says, his teammates rolled their eyes at the fresh-faced, apple-cheeked quarterback. But then, seconds later, the Patriots would execute the exact play that Christian had divined. This happened over and over as they all feasted on pizza. Now just think about that for a second. These offensive linemen, and we know that Christian Hackenberg's offensive linemen in 2013, they were upperclassmen. They were juniors and seniors. Guys about to graduate. They were 22, 23 years old, 21 years old, whereas Christian Hackenberg is 18 years old. This kid, could you imagine the amount of confidence? Now, I played college football for 1 year. And I also played high school football. I noticed that there is a big difference of when you're a freshman versus when you're a senior. When you're a senior, you're the one on top. You expect the younger guys to listen to you. You're the one that barks out the orders. But when you're, and even if you think you know certain information, you keep your mouth shut because you feel like it's not your place to talk. This kid comes in as a extremely vibrant young man, believes in what he's saying, believes in what he knows, so much so that he's willing to express it to upperclassmen. And you know what? He ends up being right. The piece continues to say, and this is, again, this is talking about the good 2013 days of Christian Hackenberg. Christian says, "We ran the Patriots playbook basically verbatim my freshman year. I watched more tape of Tom Brady than probably anyone outside of the New England organization. I love the fact that it was a quarterback-driven system and that I had the ability to change things at the line just like Brady." That's awesome, right? You want your quarterback to have that. Those are traits that you want to see a freshman. And this is what everyone says about Christian Hackenberg, is this kid was making these calls as a freshman, running a pro-style offense as a freshman. Forget a freshman, but most college quarterbacks, even if they're a senior, don't run a pro-style offense, don't have that type of ability to make those types of checks at the line of scrimmage. If this kid can do it as a freshman, the sky is the limit as to when he can be a senior. But then we notice a change in tide. Things start to be a little bit different. Let's talk about the bad 2014 days, Christian's sophomore season. The piece says, as the losses and the interceptions mounted, Penn State would finish 2-6 in the Big Ten, and Hackenberg would throw 15 picks. Christian became increasingly withdrawn. On the sideline, he often stood apart from his teammates with a distant stare carved on his face. In the post-game press conferences, his mood could be sullen as he pulled his baseball cap low and gave clipped answers to reporters. NFL scouts took note of the possible attitude problem. During the week, Christian didn't want to leave his on-campus apartment. He stopped returning phone calls from his parents, high school friends, and former coaches as well. And on Sunday afternoons, he typically watched NFL action alone, still replaying his own game from Saturday in his mind, throw by throw, play by play, pondering what he could have done better. Christian said, quote, "I wanted to create plays that weren't there as a sophomore, and a lot of times it washed out and ended badly." He continues, "I struggled to accept the fact that there were things that I couldn't control. I wanted to make perfect plays, and that would lead to mistakes. I got very frustrated with myself. It got to the point where I became an introvert." End quote. And I'll say this right now, being that I know some introverts, not a bad thing at all. And I don't know if Christian really knows the difference. He's a young kid. He's only 21 years old. Definitely not a bad thing at all. But being that you want your quarterback to be an outspoken leader, you don't want him to be a person that when you want him to be that person that when he's on the sideline, he's going over with his wide receivers. Okay, on this route, you can do this, this, and this. And talking to his offensive lineman, yeah, and you make this protection here, here, here. And talking to the coaches, we should run this play like this, et cetera, et cetera. You don't want him to be that person sulking on the sideline, not talking to anyone, that is just wallowing in misery. You don't want your quarterback to be that type of guy. And this is the narrative that we see. Puts on the baseball cap in his 2014 season and is just kind of keeping to himself. Nothing wrong with keeping to yourself. But in the heat of the action, that's not what you want. Okay, so that's 2014, which, by the way, was his worst season. 2013, many people would say was his best. And then you could argue that 2015 statistically was his best. But definitely 2014 was the worst in terms of analytics-based approaches, statistic-based approaches, and just the overall film grade that most people would say. But then let's look at the narrative of the 2015, Christian Hackenberg's junior season. The piece says, "But one thing did change his junior year, and that was his demeanor. One of his college professors suggested that he take off his cap and smile more in post-game interviews, which Christian did. He took up golf and discovered that alone in the pines, he could unwind and let the pressure of being Penn State's quarterback blow away in the breeze. Self-taught, he quickly became a 15 handicap. Christian said, quote, "I tried to enjoy each moment my junior year. Even if people were writing bad stories about me, and things were tough on the field. All the close people in my life reminded me of how lucky I was just to be playing college football at Penn State. All right, so what do we make of all this? Well, I'll say this again. I think those qualities that you did see him in as a freshman, I think that is the true Christian Hackenberg. He's just a kid that, let's be honest, he was not playing with a lot of talent around him. What receivers was he throwing to? No one really to speak of. If any of these kids, you know, make a serious impact in the NFL, I would be truly surprised. Any running backs to speak of? After all, his offensive line, which was the worst supporting cast on offense, they were converted defensive linemen. They were that bad. And really, truly, they are bad. Look at week one versus the Temple Owls. He gets sacked 9 or 10 times. There was a point in time when only 2 rushers were rushing, and they still managed to sack the kid, despite having 5 offensive linemen block. I mean, that is just absolutely unacceptable. Okay? And we're not just talking like a coverage sack, too. We're talking about a sack in a matter of split seconds. So I think that's more of what his character is that 2013 kid. Yeah, sure. Everyone can get down and get downtrodden, I guess. Even look at Tom Brady, for example. They compare him to a lot, and I think it's extremely unfair for anyone to compare Christian Hackenberg to Tom Brady, because I'll tell you right now, he's not going to be anything like Tom Brady. But even at times when things aren't going well in a Patriots game, just go back to the recent Super Bowl, Tom Brady's recent most successful game. What is he doing as the tide seems to be turning in the Seahawks' favor? They catch the deep pass. It looks like Marshawn Lynch is about to run it in from the goal line. Tom Brady's not really talking to anyone. He's just looking down, staring down. There are times when Tom Brady, you know, he cries on the sideline a little bit. He gets angry at people. Again, you want your quarterback to be a leader. And Tom Brady, no doubt, is that. And I think Christian Hackenberg has shown enough of those traits that he is that. Let's be honest, he's not Jay Cutler. Jay Cutler's the type of guy that, when have you ever really seen him make positive leadership type of qualities? You know, have you ever seen him have a post-game press conference or anything like that where you're like, man, I'd like to run through a brick wall for this guy as my teammate, or I'd love to block for this guy. I don't want anyone to touch my quarterback. Sometimes you see offensive linemen like a Breno Giacomini or a Willie Colon. Jets fans will know who these guys are. Someone sacks their quarterback and they're getting on the defensive lineman and they're hitting them after the play and stuff because, you know, they're fighting for their quarterback. I don't know of many offensive linemen that would want to do that for Jay Cutler. You know, and I guess, of course, people would do that. I'm embellishing and exaggerating a little bit. But there's many other people that they would like to do that for more than him. Jay Cutler's not a good leader. He's never really shown those types of great leadership characteristics. Christian Hackenberg has. So my questions and my concerns for Christian Hackenberg isn't his character or his leadership ability. I think he's shown enough of that. My concerns more so come from technique and other things, which I don't know if it's quite correctable. Accuracy is a big thing for me. I don't know how you can play quarterback in the NFL nowadays when you are so inaccurate. I don't know how you can do it. But anyway, I'll address more of my concerns in the next couple of segments. All right, so next up in the discussion is that of hand size. Christian Hackenberg's hand size and how that might project him to being a NFL franchise quarterback. Okay, now, let's just say this. Anyone that listens to this show with consistency will know that I was all for the Jets using Muhammad Wilkerson as a trade ploy to obtaining Jared Goff. Now, Muhammad Wilkerson and the Jets, it's actually funny that I'm recording this particular segment just after the 4 p.m. deadline has passed, and it looks like the Jets have not come to a deal with Muhammad Wilkerson. It's 4:04 p.m. right now, and as far as I know, I haven't heard any news of that. Now, it looks like for quite some time, the Jets and Wilkerson have been at odds with one another. So I was not optimistic that a deal would get done. And even though I love Muhammad Wilkerson as a player, I was all for trading him away in order to obtain a franchise quarterback, because I believe a quarterback is that valuable. And I liked enough what I saw on the Jared Goff tape to want to trade Muhammad Wilkerson away to obtain Goff. You still got Leonard Williams and Sheldon Richardson. They're good defensive linemen. Maybe they're not Muhammad Wilkerson. Maybe they'll never be Muhammad Wilkerson. But you'll still have them, and then you'll have a quarterback for the future. I was high on Goff. Now, one of the knocks on Jared Goff is his hand size, 9-inch hands. And I was thinking during the time, oh, who cares? 9-inch hands, what does it really matter? He's got small hands. Does the guy really have fumbling problems? If he doesn't have fumbling problems, then what is the deal? Right? You would think to yourself that a much bigger indicator of a quarterback's success is his overall size. Is he tall or is he short? He's got to be able to see over the line of scrimmage. Now, Jared Goff is rather tall. He is 6'4". He's not the biggest dude in the world. He's rather lean. A lot of teams say that he needs to bulk up. But you would think that height is probably more important for a quarterback. You want him to be that 6'4 Tom Brady, 6'5 Peyton Manning, Eli Manning. You want him to be a big dude that can kind of see over the line of scrimmage. You know, Cam Newton, the MVP, everyone talks about how big he is. You can't have a conversation with, you know, Cam Newton, how good he is, without someone talking about how big he is. So you would think that height is a little bit more important. But let me just post this out to you. All right. Now, we've seen several short quarterbacks in relative recent years have success and win Super Bowls and be the face of their franchise. Most notably, Drew Brees, who's about 6 feet tall, and he's almost assuredly going to go down as a Hall of Fame quarterback. He was an early second-round pick. And Russell Wilson, who had the talent of a first-rounder, but because of his size, he was knocked in the draft process, and he was taken in the third round. Now, he's 5'11". He went on to win a Super Bowl and very well could have won another one. If you look at what he did over the second half of the 2015 NFL season, over his last seven games, I think he had 24 touchdowns to one or two interceptions, something insane like that. Now, those guys, despite the fact that they're short, have relatively high releases and they're very successful. Now, I'm going to pull up an interesting tweet from Benjamin Albright. And he does a lot of work with quarterbacks. You can go to his page and you can view a pinned Google document that he has of the quarterbacks that he's done since the last, I don't know, 8 or so years. And he keeps track, and he has basically thresholds. And he does have a hand size threshold. To him, that's something that's important. Keep in mind that I don't know if he has a height threshold, but I think he's of the school of thought that hand size is a more important thing. And he said in a tweet, the only quarterback in the last 20 years to experience any NFL success with under 9 1/8 inch hands is Michael Vick. Romo had second measure at 9 3/8 inch. Now, there's a lot of talk that Tony Romo had under 9-inch hands. Albright dispels saying that that's a myth. He doesn't have 8-something-inch hands. His second measurement was 9 3/8 inch. Now, you have to keep in mind with Tony Romo, Tony Romo was an undrafted guy, so I don't even know if he went to the combine, and if he did go to the combine, maybe it was just a throw. So who knows if there was any official standard measurement for Tony Romo's hands, but there definitely seems to be a lot of discrepancy out there with that. Interestingly enough, Ryan Tannehill, another AFC East quarterback, has 9-inch hands. Now, it's hard to argue and say that he hasn't had any NFL success. I mean, he's made it onto a second contract with the team that drafted him, 8th overall. You know, if you're a top 10 draft pick and you're a bust, typically a team's not going to want to re-sign you. So he's at least a competent NFL quarterback. You cannot say that Tannehill's not, but he has 9-inch hands. So I would like to make that amendment to his tweet that Ryan Tannehill, his 9-inch hand, has had at least relative NFL success. I'm not a big Michael Vick fan. You know, never really was a huge fan of his game. Even when he was good, I always thought he would get hurt because of his dangerous playing style here and there. And when your quarterback is on the shelf, you're not really doing all that much good for your team. So even saying that Michael Vick, I think that's a little bit of a stretch as well. But here's what I'm asking. Now, the information that was just presented to you, it certainly makes a compelling argument. Okay, if you have small hands, you can't really play quarterback and be very successful. And what I said at the beginning was mostly it's because of fumbling, right? Now, let's look at those two quarterbacks that were just mentioned. Drew Brees and Russell Wilson both have very big hands. Russell Wilson's are 10 and a quarter inch. Drew Brees has somewhere around 10 something inches as well. Now, Drew Brees is pretty good with ball security. Russell Wilson fumbles at a higher rate. Now, you could say that maybe that's because he moves the ball a lot more, because he scrambles a lot. You know, he had close to 1,000 rushing yards this year, or was that last year? The point is Russell Wilson moves a lot. So you could say that maybe that's part of it as well. But Russell Wilson, even though he's got really, really big mitts, almost a full inch bigger than the guy I'm about to say, is Alex Smith. And Alex Smith is another of a mobile quarterback. He doesn't move nearly at the rate that Russell Wilson does, but he had a good amount of rushing yards. He's a guy that can move around, extend plays. He only has 9 3/8 inch hands. Now, he's fumbled much less than Russell Wilson. Okay, so is it always a direct correlation? I don't know that we can say that. Okay, well, if it's not just about fumbling, then what is it then? Well, I pulled a lot of this information for this particular segment about hand size from a piece that Bruce Feldman, who does a lot of work, he actually wrote a book called The QB, The Making of Modern Quarterbacks, and he writes for Fox Sports. And he did an extensive research based on quarterbacks' hand size. And he said it's more about being able to grip the ball in inclement weather than it is solely about fumbling. Okay, gripping the ball in inclement weather. Okay, so let's look at that a little bit. Okay, so Teddy Bridgewater is a quarterback that I liked a lot. Now, I didn't see a lot from Geno Smith his rookie year. He obviously went 8-8, but looked pretty bad. He had numbers very similar to that of Mark Sanchez. In a lot of those games that he lost, I know he went 8-8, but a lot of those losses were blowouts and looked terrible in those. Now, granted, he was throwing to bad players. But in my eyes, if you see a franchise quarterback there, you take him. The Carolina Panthers, they drafted Jimmy Clausen pretty early in the second round, had a terrible season. The very next season, what did they do? They drafted Cam Newton first overall. How did that work out for them? All right, so just because you drafted a quarterback in the second round, in early rounds, that shouldn't sway you from drafting a quarterback early in the first round in the future year, especially if he's worth it. Now, Teddy Bridgewater slid all the way to number 18, and I wanted the Jets to take him. Instead, they took Calvin Pryor. Okay, maybe that's a decent draft pick, but in my eyes, I'm still relatively angry at the Jets for that, not taking Teddy Bridgewater. Now, Teddy Bridgewater was knocked basically for his pro day. He didn't wear gloves. He didn't throw. He wore gloves in college. He was good in college. Had great tape, great film. You know, Matt Miller repeatedly took shots in the media for saying that Teddy Bridgewater, you know, he's right up there. Not at the same level as Andrew Luck, but has a he's the closest to him in quarterbacks that he's evaluated in recent years. But anyway, some were wondering, okay, well, maybe part of the reason why Teddy couldn't grip the ball well is because he has small hands. Teddy Bridgewater has 9 1/4 inch hands. Okay, now, again, that is under the Benjamin Albright QB hand size threshold. But from this same Bruce Feldman piece, I'm going to read to you an excerpt about Teddy Bridgewater's hands and how he's been thus far in the NFL. Because, again, many people will say that it's more so than fumbling issues, it's being able to hold the ball in inclement weather. And we all know Minnesota is very, very cold. And we're not talking about the Minnesota Vikings of 5-10 years ago when they used to play in the Dome. They were playing games outside last season. Think about the Seahawks playoff game, the 9-10 game, where the kicker shanked the field goal at the end. That game was super cold. Now, Bridgewater's small hands haven't seemed to be an issue. In fact, according to the Star Tribune, in the two coldest games at TCF Bank Stadium, which also rank among the top 10 coldest in franchise history, the Vikings defeated Carolina 31-13 in 2014 when the game time temperature was 12 degrees, and they beat the Giants 49-17 in 2015 when the game time temperature was 13 degrees. In those two games, Bridgewater was a combined 30 for 46, 65.2% completion percentage, with three touchdowns and no interceptions, while the two opposing QBs, Cam Newton and Eli Manning, were combined 33 for 64, which is 51.5%, with a TD and four INTs. Now, keep in mind, that 2014 game, Cam Newton had Kelvin Benjamin. In 2015, was this the game that Odell Beckham was suspended for? I'm not entirely sure. But regardless, the Giants still had decent receiving options. Okay, Teddy Bridgewater wasn't really throwing to great receivers last year, and I think that's one of the biggest reasons why you didn't see him succeed at the rate that you want. Regardless, he was still good enough. And even in the playoff game, crunch time came, Teddy Bridgewater brought his team down the field, made a couple clutch throws on third down, all right, and brought his team within field goal range. He couldn't control that his kicker was going to miss a 27-yarder. So this kid has played in inclement weather with small hands. You know, and even if you want to take the comparison, you know, Cam Newton and Eli Manning, they both have big hands. They're both big quarterbacks. They didn't play at the same rate that he did. So is it a direct correlation, hand size? Does it lead to fumbling? Does it lead to an ability to not be able to hand the ball in inclement weather? As we all know, the Jets stadium, particularly the old stadium, was known for its gusting wind flurries and stuff because of its geographical location and the way the stadium was situated. But, you know, throwing balls at MetLife Stadium can be a tough task. It's an outside place. You know, you have cold games for sure. Will Christian Hackenberg be able to do this? You think about him as a really big quarterback. He's got that size. You want 6'4", 223, right? That's right around Tom Brady. And he's not a fat 6'4", 225. Like, he's got some really broad shoulders if you look at the kid. But he's got small hands. And if you look at it, very, very few quarterbacks with that size have been successful. Can you think of quarterbacks? I've named Michael Vick, Tony Romo, and Ryan Tannehill. All very small hands. Now, Romo's a little bit above that threshold. But how many of them have been successful? And another quote from this piece about hand size says, at the time ESPN researched that, since 2008, there have been 39 quarterbacks who had been measured with a hand size of 9.25 inch or smaller hands. Remember, Teddy Bridgewater has those same amount, that same hand size. Less than one-fifth of them have gone on to start half the season in the NFL, and none had made the Pro Bowl. Now, you have to also consider this. Teddy Bridgewater made the Pro Bowl, but he did not have a good season statistically. This is a day and age when quarterbacks are constantly having substitutes in the Pro Bowl for them. You know, think of, we had Vince Young in the Pro Bowl a couple years ago. David Garrard in the Pro Bowl a couple years ago. These guys don't belong in the Pro Bowl. Why did they make the Pro Bowl? Because the guys that have been there year in, year out, they always say, you know what, I'm not going to go to the Pro Bowl this year. They don't play in it. So backups get a bid at the Pro Bowl. Even considering that, no quarterback with 9.25 inch hands or smaller. Since 2008, all these quarterbacks measured, 39 of them with 9.25 inch hands or smaller. None made the Pro Bowl, or even for that, started half the season. Christian Hackenberg is under that threshold of 9.25 inch hands. I didn't spend a great amount of time looking up how many times he's fumbled. Maybe one of you listeners can find that information. It wasn't a huge problem that I've seen in terms of him fumbling, but can he handle the ball well? You have to ask yourself, you know, he was throwing at Penn State. Can get cold up there. Is because he's got small hands, did that lead the reason for some of his inaccurate passes at times? Maybe he didn't grip the ball right, and that led to him throwing it in the dirt. Maybe, just maybe. But the point is after doing a little bit more research, I've at least come to appreciate that maybe hand size does matter a little bit more than we're led to believe. But you also have to ask yourself this question. Typically, a guy that is smaller, you know, if he's got small hand size, he's typically not a great quarterback anyway. So it seems like many of these guys that do have small hand size, more often than not, they're those smaller types of quarterbacks that come out and they try to make the NFL as a late round draft pick or an undrafted free agent. They go to the combine, they get their hand size measured, and they're just they just didn't have the arm talent to be a good quarterback in the NFL. I definitely think that that's the case, that most of these guys that have small hand size are those types of quarterbacks. But at the end of the day, you still can't account for the fact that really any quarterback with small hand size, you can't think of one in recent memory that has been extremely successful. It just doesn't exist. You can't find it. So it should be at least, if not a minor one, it should be one, a cause for concern. All right, quick update. As I recorded the last segment, it was a little well after 4 p.m., and the Jets had not agreed to Mohamed Wilkerson. You could see all the Jets fans saying, ugh, well, you know, goodbye, Mo. Thanks for what you've done. Some were even saying, season's over. JETS, just end the season. That type of behavior was out there. And, you know, I kind of looked at it saying, okay, well, just couldn't come to a long-term deal with him. You know, you just heard what I said in the last segment. You know, it is what it is. You still got other two good defensive linemen that can do similar things to what he can do. But news came recently that they actually did sign him to a long-term contract extension. So just wanted to put that out there, even though this has nothing to do with Christian Hackenberg. They did sign Mohamed Wilkerson long-term, 5 years, about $17 million a year. I think that's about $85 million in totality. Haven't seen numbers for the contract breakdown yet, how much money he's getting in what given years and what the guaranteed figures are. But regardless, this is about Christian Hackenberg. Okay, so next I want to talk about is the wonderlic score. Now, what is the wonderlic test? This is something that has been used for a long time in the NFL to assess a player's, not only his knowledge, but how quickly he can work through things. Right? And you think about a football field, I mean, things happen in split seconds. I mean, when you think about how long players are actually playing in a football game, it's just a matter of minutes over the course of a game. I know a game takes 3.5 hours or so, but plays are only about 5, 6, 7 seconds. They're that short. So you have to be able to think and process things in a split second, because it's short bursts of energy where you're sprinting, you're giving everything you got in those short bursts. So you got to be able to think quickly and on your feet. So the wonderlic test is a 12-minute test where people can basically, you know, solve problems within a short period of time. I could read a Wikipedia entry about it, but I think that you get the basic premise of it. It's been used in NFL circles for a very long time. I would say that its importance is maybe dying down more in recent years, I think. Used to see a lot more scores for other players such as, or other positions such as wide receivers, cornerbacks, defenders, etc. Now, typically, you only see the scores really thrown out there for quarterbacks. Regardless, there is still something to be said for a quarterback, you know, what his intelligence level should be. You know, you could, I guess, live with a wide receiver or a defensive lineman, maybe, you know, just go out and get the quarterback, you know, but I guess you could live with a dumber defensive lineman. You cannot live with a dumber quarterback. Your quarterback needs to know what he's doing. You can't just have skills and expect to be a good quarterback. You also have to be heady and understand the mental aspect of the game. So that's why we see in recent years, when after people go to the combine, you see wonderlic scores released, and it's pretty much just for quarterbacks, not for other positions. Not saying they don't do it, but the stress and the importance is for quarterbacks. Now, Christian Hackenberg scored a 24, which seemed to be pretty low and disappointing, because conventional knowledge about the kid is he's a very smart kid. In fact, he even goes on Gruden's QB camp and he said, you're going to get a very smart player. You know, he kind of said it all braggadociously on Gruden's QB camp. Like, hey, listen, I might not be the most accurate in the world. I might not have the best statistics in the world, but I am smart. That's one of the things that he was kind of, you know, resting his laurels on. And you're going to hear me play in a later segment where someone like Brett Coleman is saying, this is a very smart quarterback, you know, and not comparing his intelligence to Tom Brady's, but saying he's a very heady player like that. Now, Christian Hackenberg got a 24. And why does that seem low? Well, it seems low is because nowadays players study for the test more than they ever did before. Nowadays, you can take one of these tests online. Nowadays, you hire, you know, people to train you and stuff, and they're not just training you physically, but they're also training you mentally, and you best believe that they're giving them multiple wonderlic tests in multiple different formats. So what you've noticed over the years is that scores generally have risen over the years. Okay? So you could say that the fact that he had a relatively kind of low score for a starting quarterback is all the bit more alarming. But let me just, for you Jets fans out there that want a sense of optimism, let me give you one. All right, first things first is I don't claim to be a very intelligent guy, especially when it comes to math, because there's a lot of math on here. And honestly, I wonder what the hell does math have to do with football? You know, I think the first time I took the test, I was spending way too much time. You only get 12 minutes. And I got most of the questions I did right, but I was spending way too much time, especially on the math stuff. I was trying to compute stuff, and I really didn't go to a high level in math in school. So those math questions were really screwing me up. So I said, screw it. You know what? And I got maybe like, I got somewhere in the high teens the first time I did it. The second time I did it, I went and anything that seemed like a complicated math problem, I just skipped it. And I thrived on the language questions, the ones about grammar and which sentence works best in this structure, which word fits most appropriately, because most of the questions are like that. Which one of these words is not alike the rest? You get questions like that. And I thrived in those questions. I think the second time I took it, I think I got like a 33, which is the same score that Tom Brady got when he was coming out. Okay? And again, I don't claim to be a very smart guy or anything like that. And that's 9 points above what Hackenberg got. Now, you best believe that Hackenberg was studying it before. Now, did they make him take it on a paper test? I'm not entirely sure. I took it via a mobile device. Or did I take it on my computer? I think I took it on my computer, actually. But regardless, it's something that you can study for. Now, let me just list off a list of interesting wonderlic scores. Chad Pennington, we all like to think of him as a very limited quarterback. Didn't have the arm strength. You know, he was a first-round pick. Obviously, his arm eroded throughout the years after the shoulder surgeries, but we like to think of him as a smart quarterback. And he came back and he beat the Jets in Week 17 and brought Miami to their last playoff berth back in 2008. And let me tell you what, Chad Pennington wasn't doing it because he had a tremendously talented arm or because he had mobile feet. That wasn't the reason. It's because he knew how to run an offense in the NFL. He was a smart player. He had a 25. Donovan McNabb, Super Bowl playing quarterback, went to multiple NFC championship games. He had a 14. Terry Bradshaw, four-time Super Bowl winning quarterback. He had a 15. Dan Marino, Miami's golden boy. He had a 16. And again, this is a long time ago, so this is why I've said that scores have typically risen throughout the years, but still, that's considered a low score. Steve McNair also played in the Super Bowl. 15. Jim Kelly, Hall of Famer. Buffalo Bills golden child, he had a 15. Randall Cunningham, Eagles Hall of Fame, he had a 15. Vinny Testaverde, some really good years with the Jets, brought them to the AFC title game, was winning at halftime, a 17. Derek Carr, we like to think of one of the bright young talents in the NFL, right? He made the NFL top 100 this past year. Very high Pro Football Focus grades, has a good arm. People like this kid a lot. Comes from a football family. After all, his brother David Carr was a former number one overall pick. That says, you know, you come from a family that eats, breathes, and sleeps football, you're probably going to be a pretty smart guy. He got a 20. Teddy Bridgewater, he also got a 20. We're thinking of a player that is supposed to be very advanced in the game, running pro-style concepts in college. Only got a 20. Teddy Bridgewater. Cam Newton, a 21, MVP, Heisman Trophy winner, Super Bowl contender. Brett Favre, another Hall of Famer, a 22. Carson Palmer, the brother of Jordan Palmer, a 26. Get this one, my friends. Arguably, I know my Patriots listeners out there will disagree vehemently on this one. Peyton Manning, only a 28. That's 4 points above Christian Hackenberg. Only a 28. I mean, and I say this because we think of Peyton as the smartest guy out there. Who is a smarter NFL player than Peyton Manning? Rex Ryan said famously before the Jets squared off with the Colts in the 2010 playoffs that, listen, Brady's smart and he studies hard, but he doesn't study like Manning. Not like Manning. Think of all the calls that he makes at the line of scrimmage. I remember playing Madden way back in the day, like Madden 2004 or 2003 or something. And this is before I even watched football consistently. I started playing Madden and I liked the game more than actually watching games back then. And the one quarterback that was so annoying to play against was Peyton Manning, because and I'm talking about playing against a computer, because he would always make all these audibles and I couldn't figure out why. Then when I started watching the game a couple years later, you see him doing this the same things at the line of scrimmage. Again, he's supposed to be a really smart quarterback, but he only had a 28. Now let's look at some high scores of some quarterbacks that actually really weren't all that good. Ryan Fitzpatrick, a 48. This guy finished the test in like 4 minutes or 5 minutes, something like that. It's like a record. And he only got two questions wrong. Greg McElroy, another Jets player that Jets fans will know about, and he's infamous. He's famous for all the wrong reasons. He's known for coming in and saving the Jets in a meaningless game at MetLife Stadium against the lowly Arizona Cardinals that year, in which they won 7-6. Mark Sanchez tossed about four picks in that game. But Greg McElroy is considered a smart dude. Maybe he doesn't have the arm and all that type of stuff, but he is smart. He had a 48, but where was he in the NFL? Blaine Gabbert, what an epic bust he was. Maybe he's going to, you know, rejuvenate his career out with Chip Kelly out in San Francisco. He had a 42. Drew Henson, another 42. Patriots fans will know him as he got some quarterback reps over Tom Brady at the University of Michigan. Ryan Nassib, playing second fiddle to Eli Manning over at the New York Giants. He got a 41. Brian Greasy, 38. Colin Kaepernick, a 38, 10 points above Peyton Manning, 5 points above Tom Brady. Again, you can study for it. You know, he came out much later than these guys did, so understandable he's going to get a higher score. Or, you know, his score should at least be inflated for that reason. Still, a 38. I don't think of Colin Kaepernick as a heady, smart quarterback. I think of Colin Kaepernick as a guy that can do well within a given system. You get him on the move, get some, you know, read option schemes in there. You know, this is the type of quarterback Colin Kaepernick is. Extremely big arm, but he's not a smart quarterback. But he got a 38. Matt Flynn, a 38. Akili Smith? Does any of us think of Akili Smith as a smart quarterback? 37. Again, you can go on and on with this. But what I'm trying to say is, when I took the test, I thought to myself, what do any of these questions have to do with football? I get it. It's problem solving in a short given time, and you want your quarterback or any NFL player to be able to have those skills where you can solve things in the split second, where you can think quickly on your feet. But what do language questions, what is grammar, what does math problems, complex math problems, have to do with whether or not you know to run this route on this option route, whether or not you know how to call this protection, whether or not you know how to go to this read if that read is being taken away? I'm asking again the question, what does it really have to do? So the wonderlic, after I took it and after I looked at these scores, I became disenchanted with it. And I really don't think that it matters all too much. So the fact that Christian Hackenberg got a 24, do I think that he's not a smart quarterback because of that? No, I don't think that that's the case. But just because people say that he's a smart quarterback, I'm also not sold just because they're saying that about him, just because he ran a pro-style system. But again, wonderlic, I think it's a piece to the puzzle, but I would put very, very, very little stock in it. So when I was younger, for the life of me, I couldn't figure out why certain quarterbacks that were in college and great college players at that, Heisman Trophy winners and Heisman Trophy candidates, couldn't understand why they wouldn't translate and be a good NFL quarterback. Conversely, quarterbacks in college that maybe only went about 500, weren't a great winner, weren't in the big-time bowls, These guys were getting drafted in the first round. And it wasn't until, you know, many years ago now, but I'm much older now, that I've come to realize you need a certain level of talent to be able to play in the NFL. You need a certain level of arm strength. Certain throws that you can make in college aren't going to work in the NFL. The DBs close much quicker. Certain play designs don't work in the NFL as they worked in college. You need a quarterback with a strong arm. It's just the way it is. You pass way too much in the NFL to not have that. Now, the next segment is going to be about quarterback velocity, because it's one of the few ways that we can, in terms of metrics and analytics, analyze a quarterback's arm strength. You know, we can look at people on the field and say, oh, that guy's got a big arm. But when we put it to the radar gun, how do we stack them up with others? So I've put together a list of quarterbacks since 2008 that what their numbers were. What were their miles per hour in quarterback velocity? Now, you may be wondering, okay, well, how exactly is this assessed? And I had the same question. I was wondering, is this one particular throw? Is this an average of their throws? How do they come to this specific number? Now, this is done by our lads. They have a scouting service, and they do this at the NFL Combine every year. So not every quarterback since 2008 is listed, because as we know, and this is a trend, guys that are typically going to be a top five, top 10 pick, they don't throw at the Combine. You know, we've seen that certain quarterbacks have Cam Newton, but Andrew Luck didn't. So not every quarterback does it. And I wanted to get further clarification on exactly how they assess this. So I tweeted at Mr. Dan Shanka, who runs Our Lads, and he said, quote, I posted each quarterback's strongest 15-yard out route pass from left or right from peak to catch. All throws were made from the opposite hash, end quote. Okay, so think about that. Obviously, it takes a very strong pass to make a 15-yard out route from the opposite hash. You need to have a strong arm to be able to do that. So it seems like it's a very appropriate throw. This is a throw where you drive it. You know, it's not necessarily one of those where you're just floating it up and having a high arc and you're throwing a bomb downfield. So it's kind of one of those ones where it's a very common throw in the NFL. It's a throw that's made frequently, but you need a good amount of arm juice to be able to do it. So I'm going to read off to you a list of quarterbacks' miles per hour that they clocked in at the gun. Now, keep in mind, this is their strongest 15-yard out route. It's not an average of their throws. So maybe, and also I maybe should have asked, it doesn't necessarily say whether or not the pass was accurate, right? Because you could have a very strong throw that has a very high velocity, but maybe it's inaccurate. And obviously you want to be accurate as well as have a strong arm in the NFL. But regardless, let's look at some of the numbers. Paxton Lynch clocked in with a 59 from this past season. That was the strongest in the class. Jared Goff, the number one overall pick, had a 58. Carson Wentz, the number two overall pick, had a 57. Tied for fourth was Christian Hackenberg and the other AFC East quarterback, Jacoby Brissett. Now, each team in the AFC East drafted a quarterback. The Miami Dolphins selected Brandon Doughty, who clocked in with a 53 miles per hour. And Vernon Adams, one of Draft Twitter's favorite, who went undrafted, obviously, and he's going to be playing in the CFL, he also threw a 53. And Cardale Jones did not throw at the Combine, so we did not have his numbers. Okay, so that is from this most recent draft class. Now let's look at the 2015 draft class. Marcus Mariota, he threw a 56. That is the same exact as Christian Hackenberg. Jameis Winston, a 55. That's lower than Christian Hackenberg. Bryce Petty, Jets quarterback that was drafted, he threw a 53. And one of the things that people would say about Petty is he's got a pretty big arm. Okay, well, interesting. And I posted two other ones that are pretty irrelevant, but it just goes to show you like how big the drop-off is. Nick Marshall, who's a converted, I think he's playing cornerback in the NFL now, a 50, and Blake Sims, who, you know, obviously had a pretty good rapport with Amari Cooper and was tossing him the rock, a 42. Jeez. Only two names to speak of from the 2014 class, Logan Thomas, who spent some time with Miami, 60 miles per hour. That's really, really fast. Jimmy Garoppolo, 56. That's the same as Christian Hackenberg. Let's look at 2013. Some early selected AFC East quarterbacks in this draft. Geno Smith with a 55 miles per hour. That's 1 mile per hour slower than Christian Hackenberg. EJ Manuel, the only first round draft pick out of that quarterback class, a 54. And this one is interesting. Many people are always clamoring, hey, trade for this guy. You might ask yourself, because there was talk about this guy going in the top 10 that year, and he didn't even come close to that. He went in the third round. Mr. Napoleon Dynamite himself, Mike Glennon, clocked in with a 49. And people like to say that he's got a big arm because he's big. He even compared himself to Joe Flacco coming out. And you have to ask yourself, well, are a lot of the passes that he's throwing, maybe he can throw a decent deep ball downfield where it kind of arcs and sails and maybe it can go far in terms of yardage. But in terms of how fast he can gun the ball in there, doesn't seem like he's got much velocity to speak of. Let's go to the 2012 class. This one really shocked me. Kirk Cousins, a 59. That's the same as what Paxton Lynch threw. This one, not so shocking. Knew that he had a good arm. It was the other things that mattered and that were question marks. Brandon Weeden, a 59. Russell Wilson, 55 miles per hour. That's the same as Geno Smith. That's 1 mile per hour slower than Christian Hackenberg. Another one of note, Kellen Moore, 52 miles per hour. The reason I wrote him down is because a lot of people think of him as having a very weak arm. We like to think of him coming in during that Jets game, Jets versus Dallas in December, and just not being able to make the appropriate throws. You know, maybe having the mental smarts, but not having the arm talent. 2011, Colin Kaepernick, 59 miles per hour. Okay, that's not shocking. We knew that he had a big arm, especially when it comes to, you know, bulleting the ball in there. You know, this guy was also a pitcher. So, Andy Dalton, 56. That's the same as Christian Hackenberg. Cam Newton, 56. Christian Ponder, 51. Wrote him down because that's pretty low for a top 12 draft pick. And this one was really shocking to me because I think he's got a pretty good arm. Tyrod Taylor, 50 miles per hour. Let's look at 2010. I only wrote down two quarterbacks, Colt McCoy. Now, it's interesting to note that he did not throw at the combine. This is the only person that had such a little asterisk. His throw was recorded at a private workout with a radar gun and a computer chip in the ball. So it's a little bit of a different assessment process than the rest of the quarterbacks. Armonte Edwards. He's another converted quarterback. He's playing something else, or I don't even know if he's still in the NFL. Maybe he's playing receiver or something. 46.5 miles per hour, and that's really slow. 2009, Mark Sanchez with a 57. That's a top five pick. Josh Freeman with a 57. That's a first-round draft pick, number 17 overall to the Tampa Bay Bucks. Now let's look at the last year that we have to speak of. Joe Flacco, 55 miles per hour. Josh Johnson, 49 miles per hour. Colt Brennan, 44 miles per hour. He's one of those guys I was thinking of. Had a lot of college success, but just never got a fair shake in the NFL. Maybe that's why. Matt Flynn, 50 miles per hour. John David Booty, 51 miles per hour. Okay. Now, like I said before, there's a lot of quarterbacks that are highly touted. They come in the combine and they say, why do I need to throw? I got so much good actual college tape on me that if people really question my arm strength, just go back to the tape. The tape tells it all. They don't want to go to the combine and throw to receivers that they're not familiar with, because if you throw a couple bad passes to guys that you don't have a rapport with and everyone's watching you, that can maybe hurt your draft stock. So if you already got a high draft stock, there's no need to try to improve it beyond necessary. So they don't throw. So here's a couple of people in recent years that didn't throw. Derek Carr, Teddy Bridgewater, RG3, Andrew Luck, Ryan Tannehill, Sam Bradford, Matthew Stafford, and Matt Ryan. all of these guys were first-round picks except for Derek Carr. And Derek Carr was an early second-rounder. Teddy Bridgewater went right at the end of the first. RG3 was number two overall. Andrew Luck was number one overall. Ryan Tannehill, eighth overall. Sam Bradford, first overall. Matt Stafford, first overall. And Matt Ryan, number three overall. Now, I went back through this list, and I started highlighting some names. I highlighted guys in blue if they've had moderate success to above average success in the NFL. And I highlighted guys in green that I've had that I think have had extreme success in the NFL, given their circumstances, their surrounding talent, how much games they've won, etc. Interestingly, all the guys that I just named that didn't throw at the combine, they've all went under the at least moderate to above moderate success in the NFL. They're all highlighted blue. Again, that's Matt Ryan, Matthew Stafford, Sam Bradford, Ryan Tannehill, RG3, Teddy Bridgewater, and Derek Carr. I highlighted one in green out of that list, and that was Andrew Luck, because I think that given the Colts roster around him, the poor offensive line, the not great defense to speak of, you could say the piss poor coaching, if you will, I think given all those circumstances, he's been a very good player. Let me go up through the lists of the previous years from guys that actually did throw at the combine. Joe Flacco, I highlighted him in blue, moderate success. 2011, Tyrod Taylor, highlighted in blue, moderate success. I highlighted Cam in green. He's had above moderate success. He's had very good success. Andy Dalton, Colin Kaepernick, they're both highlighted in blue. 2012, Russell Wilson, I highlighted him in green. He won a Super Bowl, almost won another one. Made the playoffs, what, four straight years? It's hard for me not to highlight him in green. Kirk Cousins, given last season, made the playoffs, kind of, even though people were doubting him, he kind of made the Washington Redskins watchable again. They were one of the laughingstocks. So I highlighted him in blue. I didn't highlight anyone from 2013, 2014, no one from 2009. Sorry, Mark Sanchez, no one from 2010. Let's go to 2014. Garoppolo, Logan Thomas, they're not highlighted. 2015, Jameis Winston and Marcus Mariota are both highlighted in blue. I think they both had at least pretty good rookie seasons thus far. Now, why did I highlight these people? And the reason why I did is I'm scrolling through this list of highlighted people. And again, you can rewind the podcast if you want to re-listen to some of those names. Or you can go to ourlads.com and they actually have these quarterback, you know, velocity charts and numbers. You can read it yourself. Quarterback velocity charts, Our Lads, you can find it. Everyone listed has at least around 55 miles per hour velocity. These are guys that I've highlighted. No one goes below 55 miles per hour velocity except for Tyrod Taylor. And Tyrod Taylor is the one exception. And you have to ask yourself, okay, well, the one area where Tyrod Taylor has been criticized is he didn't test the middle of the field enough. And to throw over the middle of the field, that's where passes are most oftentimes intercepted. You want to be able to gun the ball in there quickly. So you have to wonder, okay, is this maybe one of the reasons why, or is it something the way that the scheme was drawn up? I don't necessarily think it's because of the arm strength. But Tyrod Taylor, to me, doesn't have a bad arm. If you look at him throw a deep ball, he's got one of the prettiest deep balls in the league. There's no doubt about that. But with that being said, you know, those deep passes are kind of one of those ones that they arc down. You know, you're not throwing it with tremendous amounts of velocity, but it's going the long distance. You want to throw it with touch. He's one of the best in the game to do that. That's really undeniable. But he's the only one that is an outlier. And, you know, you also have to ask yourself, you know, he wasn't a very polished passer coming out. He sat the bench for 4 years. Maybe he refined his mechanics a lot and he did improve his velocity. You know, even Aaron Rodgers, who was a first round draft pick, they said, you look at his arm in college versus what it is now in the NFL. I mean, it's almost like night and day. He improved his arm strength a lot. Now, it's not common that someone could do that, but it can be done. So maybe Tyrod Taylor, with getting some, you know, fine tutelage, sitting the bench, really worked on his craft to be able to do that. And you know that he works really, really hard. But he's the one outlier. So what I'm saying is, Christian Hackenberg, when you look at his velocity, 56 miles per hour, it's pretty good. You know, it's right around where you want it to be. It passes that threshold around 55 miles per hour. All those guys that have had moderate success. Okay, so it's there. But at the same time, I'll say this. Quarterback velocity doesn't tell the whole story of whether or not your quarterback has a good arm or not. You know, Cam Newton has a phenomenal arm. You know, do I think him and Christian Hackenberg have the same type of arm strength? No, I don't. They clocked in at the same exact velocity. You know, even Mark Sanchez threw 57 miles per hour. Do I think Sanchez has a better arm than Cam Newton? Hell no, not even close. So it doesn't tell the whole story. And even though Christian Hackenberg, he passes that threshold, I still don't think he has a great arm. I really don't. I think he maybe has an above average NFL arm, or maybe it's right around average. But people like to say he's this big armed kid, big bodied kid. He's got decent size if you want to talk about his height and his weight. And he's got a decent arm for sure. You can't say he's got a bad arm. But this notion that he's got an elite level arm, a Matthew Stafford type of arm, is just not true. But at least he checks off the quarterback velocity threshold. All right, so I am joined now by Ron Caniff from the Unsquish the Fish podcast, also co-host of the Finsider Radio. You can find Ron on Twitter at Fins Broadcaster. That's F-I-N-S Broadcaster, right, Ron?
Correct.
Now, Ron, you know, I've been listening to your podcast for quite some time, been following you on Twitter, and your stuff is just blowing up, man. You know, you're always constantly getting into conversations with different Dolphins fan, and you know, you really kind of you're taking off out there, man.
I'm trying to work this social media a little bit.
Yeah, and you're also writing now too, if I'm not mistaken, right? Finmaniacs.com?
Correct. Yeah, I'm writing some articles here and there. I should be writing some more, but I am writing some articles here and there, a little bit more recently than I had, actually.
Good stuff. And is that just for Finmaniacs, or are you also doing for the SB Nation Finsider?
No, I'm exclusively writing for Finmaniacs.
All right, good stuff. So I wanted to get you in, and I wanted to talk about Ryan Tannehill, because doing this piece on Hackenberg, one thing that is constantly brought up is the fact that he's taken so many hits. Over his last two seasons in college football, 103 combined sacks in just those two seasons. And I mean, this, we're talking college football. You're only playing 11, 12 games a season, not a full 16-game season. So he's just been absolutely pummeled. And many people are saying that he's going to suffer from this David Carr syndrome. You know, he started staring at the rush. Instead of keeping his eyes downfield at his receivers, you know, he's looking at the pass rushers, and therefore he's locking on, holding on to the ball longer than possible, and not getting it out as quick as he should. And when you look at David Carr, the amount of times that he was sacked in his young career, 76 one year, 68 another year, just absolutely crushed, and that doesn't even factor in the amount of times that he was hit. But if you go and you look at the statistics of the amount of times a quarterback was sacked in a given season, ranked number 11th on that list is Ryan Tannehill with 58 sacks in 2013. Mm-hmm. And then Tannehill also ranks number 91 with 46 sacks in 2014. And then he's also at number 98 with 45 sacks in 2015. And then his rookie year, he also took about 35, 36 sacks. So he's a young quarterback that has also been pummeled in his career. You could probably say over the last 4 years in the NFL, I don't think any quarterback has been sacked or hit more than Ryan Tannehill.
Yeah, they haven't. They haven't, actually. He's been sacked the most.
Yeah, so I want to ask you this. Do you feel that his growth has been stunted because of the amount of hits that he's taken in his young career?
I don't think it's because of the amount of hits he's taken. I think his growth has been stunted just because the offensive line play in general has been bad. And that's just kept him from realizing what his full potential is. Now, his full potential may not be what we hope it's going to be, but we still don't really know what it is, because he's always played, since he started, for four straight years, he has played behind such a bad O-line that let's face it, it's harder to be a quarterback when you're getting pummeled every single game, sometimes 5, 6, 7 times, hit 10, 11 times, 12 times. That's tough to, you know, conditions to even be a quarterback under, no matter who you are. So I don't feel like it's made him regress or, made him gun shy or what have you. He's a pretty tough guy, honestly, mentally and physically. He's pretty tough. So.
Yeah, so when we're talking about young quarterbacks and whether or not they get gun shy or they stare down the rush, you haven't seen any of that with him.
Any of that? No. I've seen him get a little jittery back there. Yeah, when he starts getting really hammered in a game, I'll see in that game him get kind of, you know, a little bit on edge, could you say. But it doesn't seem to stick. It's not like, okay, he starts playing that way the rest of the season or the next game. It seems to be on a case-by-case basis. If it's a game where he's really getting pummeled, he seems to start to get a little jittery and little, you know, happy feet there and whatnot. And hanging on the ball too long, now, I don't know if that's because of, and you had mentioned that with Hackenberg, but I don't know if that's because of the O-line issues or if that's just a Tannehill thing. That's definitely been one of his big issues. That's caused some of the sacks as well. Not near as much as the O-line being poor, but that's also been a problem with him. Now, whether that's a direct correlation with the O-line or not, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think you bring up an interesting point. So you're basically saying that, you know, you don't really see it game to game. Like, yeah, he might get jittery within a certain game, but we even see some of the best guys that happens to them. Just think about Tom Brady in the AFC Championship game. We were just talking about this before we got on air. Is you look at that game, Tom Brady, he was hit more times in that game than his entire career. And if you look at that game, he was under constant pressure. And what happens? It's a two-point conversion late in the game. Gronk is wide open in the back of the end zone, but Tom Brady misses him. But you have to believe, and if you look at it, he's staring down and he's looking at the pressure. You know, Von Miller and DeMarcus Ware were in his face all day. And within that game, I mean, Brady, does he ever really get flustered from game to game, week to week? No, I mean, he's always been a player that's very calm, cool, and collected. But within certain games that he's gotten hit a lot, if you think about the Giants games in the Super Bowls, mm-hmm. he was affected from time to time. So I think what I'm getting from you is within a certain game that Ryan Tannehill has been hit a lot, yeah, maybe in that game he might get a little jittery, but it's not a thing that lasts from week to week.
Exactly. Yeah, you nailed it just like that. He'll come back and bounce back the next week, and if he's not being pummeled, which sometimes there are games. I mean, as a Dolphins fan, I'm just used to seeing Tannehill get sacked a lot. I mean, it's been 4 years. That's the way it always goes. But sometimes they'll have those games where he really doesn't get touched much. I mean, man, those have been his best games, honestly. When they keep the pressure off of him, he really seems to perform well in those games. That's why I'm kind of interested to see what this year is going to be like, because they seem to have an improved O-line. You know, when you have a new head coach, new OC, a lot new, offensive line coach, a lot of things going for us there that maybe indicate that we'll have an improved line play. So I'm hoping that we do to see if that is the standard for him when he is really untouched or not hit as much, I should say, not sacked as much. Can he really flourish in all those games or most of those games?
Yeah, and he certainly has had very good games in his young career, but then he's had some pretty poor games or some meltdown of games. If you think, you know, the Jets had played spoilers with the Dolphins a couple times, and me being a Jets fan, you know, I've seen it, you know, 2013, 2014 respectively. Mm-hmm. You guys at least have some playoff aspirations in week 17, and the Jets spoiled the season. And let's be honest, the Jets did not have a great pass rush in either of those 2 years, despite having a good defensive line, because they haven't had true edge rushers. But, you know, those were some weeks where they were really getting to the quarterback. And you could see late in those games, Ryan Tannehill kind of had a little bit of a meltdown.
Yeah, the whole offensive definitely meltdown. 2013 was very frustrating because all we had to do was go either beat the Jets or beat the Bills. Beat the Bills or and then beat the Jets, one or the other. And both neither team were as good then as they are now anyway. And I mean, we scored in 2013, we scored 7 total points in both games combined. I believe 7 points against the Jets, and I believe we were shut out against the Bills. It might have been the other way around, but I think that's how it went. And then the next year, I think we had aspirations more to be 9-7 when we were playing the Jets, but I don't think we were going to make the playoffs. I'm pretty much sure that we knew that, or we wouldn't have made it anyway had we won. But it was the same thing. The offense kind of melted down at the end. That's just kind of the way it goes. Of course, the blame has gone in many different directions. They blame the line. They blame Tannehill. They blame the coaching. I mean, they've gone in and pretty much changed everything now except for Tannehill. So we're going to find out, hopefully, what the real issues are, especially in the fourth quarter of the season in December. December is just offensively has just been bad for us in all the Tannehill years, honestly. So I'm a little nervous about that, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, well, listen, you know, the draft rolled around, and we were doing a live show, and, you know, Ron, we had even done some podcasts together where we did a mock draft, and, you know, in that mock draft, Laramie Tunsil was going, like, pick 3, I think, and, you know, we were thinking he wasn't going to get past Baltimore, but then somehow, some way, we all know, we don't even need to repeat it on air, he ends up falling to the Dolphins, and I said right before the Dolphins made that pick, I'm thinking, what is the biggest problem with the Dolphins? You know, and you had talked about linebacker being a repeated issue. I called into the Finsider one time, and I said, listen, you guys need to draft Ronnie Stanley if he's there. And you guys ended up getting a better prospect. And I said, right live on air, I said, Gary, I think the Dolphins need to take Laramie Tunsil here. I mean, to shore up that offensive line. And now you guys take him, so you have to figure that there's only upside from here. It can only improve. It can only get better. You hope that Adam Gase can only help improve that even more. So we're going to see. We're going to see what Mr. Tannehill is. But, Ron, let's think about this idea of offensive linemen. And sometimes when they have – I know you've criticized Dallas Thomas vehemently. You are not a fan of him at all.
I'm also not alone in that, but, yes, I have.
Oh, yeah. We've said many times how horrible he is. But anyway, so sometimes when, a player breaks through, sacks the quarterback, you've seen quarterbacks like Jay Cutler flail their arms, call out their offensive lineman, point the finger at them, and sets off bad body language. And if you're an offensive lineman and your quarterback is, you know, cursing you off like that, flailing their arms, mm-hmm. you know, maybe that has some type of mental effect on you. And maybe you don't block as well on the next play, or just espousing that type of body language, maybe it says that the quarterback's head isn't properly in the game. Have you seen any of this from Tannehill when he's ever taken a pummel that he's had poor body language or anything like that?
Zero. He has had zero. Zero during games, zero on the sidelines, zero afterwards, zero in press conferences. Zero. He has never once even hinted or called out his teammates in any shape or form, save the whole controversy last year about the practice trophies or what have you. But which were, you know, may or may not have been a bunch of crap. But never, 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 never has he done that, especially in a game. Never seen that. He always just gets up and goes back at it. And that's why I mean, some people argue with me that he's not mentally tough. I say he's extremely mentally tough, and he's obviously physically tough because he's taken a pounding and never missed a game. Never even been questionable, probable. Are we wondering, is he going to start or not? Never happened. But as far as being Jay Cutler or Jeff George, no, I've never seen it.
Yeah. And, you know, if you want to talk about players that have, you know, maybe some type of ability to want to blame their own teammates or be mad at their own teammates, what player more so than Ryan Tannehill, you know, could have that card? I mean, because think about the whole Mecole Grimes saga. She gets on the radio and constantly is criticizing the guy, yet you never heard a peep out of him. And you've said many times you'd love to be a fly on the wall if she were in the room with Lauren Tannehill.
Yeah, when I said that, that's when Miko, oh boy, did she go after me when I tweeted that. Oh, man, did she go crazy on me when I tweeted that. That was the first time that she ever responded to anything I ever said to her, which hadn't been much up to that point. But, man, she didn't like that. Yeah, he never has. I mean, I guess Andrew Luck's another one. I don't think I've ever really seen him blame his team, blame his O-line. And he's had definitely some issues of his own over there with the O-line.
Oh, yeah, he's been pummeled. And it finally caught up with him. And we saw him injured for the majority of last season. And he wasn't having a good season anyway. But, again, under constant pressure. And finally, the Colts addressed their offensive line issues by drafting Ryan Kelly at pick number 18. And it seems that the Dolphins have finally decided to address the offensive line here as well. So I know that you're not a huge fan of Hackenberg. Rightfully so. He was very bad the past 2 years, and you could even say that he wasn't very good his rookie year, if you want to talk about in terms of statistics and stuff. Mm-hmm. You've called him Slackenberg.
So you remember that? I didn't know anybody even caught up on that. That was really just a joke, but thanks for calling that out. That's good that you remembered that, Slackenberg.
Hey, listen, I remember things, man.
I see that. You remember everything. I got to watch you, man.
Yeah, you got to be careful, man. But anyway, so I guess you don't have much confidence in him. And honestly, doing this piece, I don't have all too much confidence in him either. But I don't know that my concerns come from this fact that, oh, he's just been hurt so much. He's just been hit so much. He's never going to be able to rebound from that. The young quarterback is ruined. I mean, if it were a thing where he got hit so much that he's got tremendous injuries that he can't recover from, maybe I'd believe in that. But just because he's been hit, I don't think that he's mentally unfit to play anymore. And what I'm gathering from your conversation, this conversation about Tannehill, is that I don't know that you think that Hackenberg can't have a successful NFL future just because he's been hit so much, but your concerns for him might be more so about his accuracy or decision making and things like that. Would you say that's accurate?
Yeah, exactly accurate. But you know, it's not even that. I think that he has a chance to develop. I've been questioning before the draft, and you know that I have. You remember everything, so I know you remember this. I just don't understand why the Jets are messing around with Fitzgerald. I mean, I understand that he wants a lot of money, but the guy really did well for you last year. And there was nothing wrong with going and drafting another quarterback, because obviously Hackenberg, I had to fight now not to say Slackenberg, he like pops in my head, because obviously Hackenberg is not, or I should say Fitzgerald is not the future. So it was fine to draft Hackenberg. I just feel like for this season, I mean, just going to throw him out there or let Geno Smith have it, or who's the other guy? I don't even remember now who the
Bryce Petty.
Bryce Petty. God, man, I mean, you guys went 10-6 and the chemistry was good, and Fitzgerald's chemistry with Decker and Brandon Marshall was good, and that's sometimes hard to find quarterbacks that have that kind of chemistry with Marshall, because he's a special kind of guy. And I don't know, it just 30 touchdowns, right, the guy threw?
31, which is a Jets franchise record.
Yeah, I mean, it just, that's more my frustration for you guys. I mean, I'll take it as a Dolphins fan, but you guys are just playing around. Now, I get that Fitzgerald at this point seems to have nowhere else to go. Doesn't he swear he's just not going to play? He's like, screw the Jets, I'm just retiring. Isn't that what he's saying? But aren't they still secretly negotiating, apparently?
That rumor had somehow got out there. And now keep in mind, Ryan Fitzpatrick hasn't spoken publicly the entire offseason until he just recently did this past week at Willie Colon's golfing outing. And for the first time, he said retirement is not an option. So I don't know how that story got out there, but you know, some of the things that are leaked to the media are complete nonsense. And I think, listen, this guy, he loves football. You know, he's got 5 kids. He's not retiring anytime soon, especially when all these millions of dollars are on the table. And you know, I see the way that the Jets are playing it, and you could say maybe it'd be a dangerous thing to trot Geno Smith out there, to trot Bryce Petty or Hackenberg out there. Yeah, that certainly seems pretty dangerous, but I think the Jets are just playing the market right. I think they realize what his value is, and they realize that no one else is willing to pay him that amount of money. So, listen, Ryan, you know, go ahead and retire. They know that he's not going to do that. They know he loves football too much. There's too much money on the table to want to do that. And I think they're just waiting for him to come back at this point.
But you guys, man, you guys really have taken some risk, and it might pay out. But I got to be honest with you. Y'all kind of pushed all your chips in the middle of the table, and the odds were not in your favor before the draft. Once the draft happened, you guys pretty much had all the leverage. But not only did you not sign Fitz, but you passed, I mean clearly passed, on Paxton Lynch. Like, yeah. That was the move, like, okay, you don't sign Fitz, and then you pass on Lynch. Like, what are they doing? I'd be honest with you, if I was a Jets fan, I'd be upset. I don't want to curse on your show. I'd be upset. You know, honestly, if the Dolphins were doing that, I would be livid. I would be going nuts on them, because they are taking such a risk. It'd be different if they were 4-12 last year and Fitz wasn't any good. Then who cares? But man, guys were 10-6, should have been a playoff team. You were better than Houston. I could tell you that right now. Jets are a better team than Houston last year. And, you know, because of the way the divisions work, they go and you don't. But I just thought it was nuts. And you guys were just taking big chances. Now, it's kind of paid off, unless Fitz really does decide, I'm not playing for you, I don't care how much you pay me. You know, which I don't think that'll happen. I think you guys will get him, but I thought it was ridiculously risky. I didn't understand what the point of all that risk was for after the season you guys had last year.
I hear you, man, and I'm all of the opinion taking multiple shots at the dartboard, eventually you'll hit the bullseye. and taking as many shots at a quarterback as he can, draft one every year. I totally support that. And, you know, I was kind of getting nervous leading up to the draft. Will Paxton Lynch indeed fall to the Jets? Because you'd heard more and more rumors that teams were interested in him and that he would go early on. He might not even make it to pick 20. But then he's there. That's the guy who I wanted. I didn't want to trade up to get him, but if he falls to 20, I'm all for taking a guy that can be a developmental type player. And then when they didn't, I was a little disappointed.
I knew you wouldn't, and here's why I knew you wouldn't. During the draft, as the draft progressed, I should say, I actually did the draft live, Finn Maniacs Live. We actually did the entire first round. It was like a four-hour podcast. It was a lot of fun. But as the draft started to progress and it got to your pick, everybody's like, they're taking Lynch, they're taking Lynch. I said, they're not taking Lynch. And here's why. If they were that infatuated with Lynch, they'd have already gone up to get him. There's no way you're going to tell me that this is the guy they want. They love Lynch. He's high on their board. Yet they were willing to sit there and hope that he falls to 20 when the two first quarterbacks that were taken were already gone, 1 and 2, and we know other teams want quarterbacks. That to me, that told me they're not going to take Lynch. You know, at that point, it just wasn't going to happen. And of course, they didn't.
Yeah, I mean, we see teams trade up to get a quarterback all the time in the first round. We saw it twice with, you know, Wentz and Goff in this round. You think back to Teddy Bridgewater, the Vikings traded back to pick 32 to get him. Obviously, the Vikings.
They did that to jump ahead of Houston because Houston didn't draft a quarterback, right? They decided, no, we're going to draft. Who was it they drafted that pick? And it was like one of the top picks.
Jadeveon Clowney.
Yeah, they took Clowney instead. And then Minnesota was smart and said, let me jump back in ahead of Houston before Houston takes him.
Yeah, and also they also wanted to get the fifth-year option on him because if you draft him in the first round versus drafting him in the second round, well, you get that fifth-year option, whereas, you know, if it's a second-round pick, well, he's just going to be on a straight-up four-year deal.
Yeah, and we've seen a lot of bad quarterbacks that people have jumped up to go take. Mark Sanchez, for your example.
Johnny Football?
Yeah, Johnny Football. I think Cleveland moved back up a little to go get Brady Quinn. Didn't the Bills jump up to go get Emmanuel? No, who was it? EJ Manuel.
They jumped back to get him.
They jumped back and then back up to go get him. And then, of course, I know they moved heaven and earth to go get Sammy Watkins, but he may end up being worth it. And then, who was the quarterback that got way overdrafted from Minnesota? Before they took Teddy Bridgewater, they took...
This was Ponder.
Oh, my Lord. So we've seen quarterbacks either overdrafted or people move up, but that's just a position that you do that in the NFL. But once it got to 20, I knew you guys weren't taking Lynch because if you were really stuck on Lynch is going to be our guy, you'd have gone to get him. I heard that you tried to go get Tunsil ahead of Miami and a few other teams, but I don't know if that was actually true or not. But I had heard that the Jets tried to move up. It was the only team I heard that tried to move up to go get Tunsil. But
yeah, I think that's a legit rumor, and apparently the Jets had offered their first-round pick, the 20th overall pick, as well as the second-round pick, with the 51st overall pick, which, ironically enough, ended up being Christian Hackenberg. So maybe, just maybe, if that's true, that kind of tells you that although Hackenberg was kind of their guy, it's not that they were all that in love with him, that there's no way that they couldn't have him because you take an offensive lineman over him and also give up your first round pick. So, I get it. The Jets, Hackenberg was their guy, but there's a reason why they didn't even trade up to get him in the second round. They waited till he went down. And we actually thought that Houston, Bill O'Brien, his former boy, you know, when he traded up one spot ahead of the Jets, I thought, he's actually coming to save us. He's going to take Hackenberg before us. And they took Nick Martin, the center out of Notre Dame. So Hackenberg ended up being there, and, you know, we'll see what's going to happen.
Yeah, it should be interesting, but I just feel like you need to get Fitz at least for another season if you can. You might regress this season, honestly.
Yeah. But how good will they – and my thing is, and I'll maintain this, how good will they be with Fitzpatrick with a tougher schedule this year? I don't see them making the playoffs. So anyway, again, talking about Hackenberg, what I sum up from this conversation is, yes, he's taken a lot of hits, but as long as those hits haven't led to injuries, it shouldn't be something that wrecks him, right?
I agree.
We've also seen other quarterbacks. If I look on this list, Blake Bortles is up there, but he's a player that's on the rise.
Big time. Big time, yeah, on the rise. 35 touchdowns last year or something?
35 touchdowns last year. And, yeah, big, you know, I'm not as high on him as some others, but, you know, people would say he's one of the young, nice quarterbacks in the league. And, you know, he's taken many sacks in his young career, many hits, not a great offensive lineman with the Jags. Mm. Luke Jokel getting hurt, never really developing, second overall pick. But again, you know, So within a certain game, yes, maybe a quarterback can get flustered. We've seen this happen with the best, Tom Brady. Think about the AFC Championship games, the Super Bowls against the Giants. But just because he has a bad outing 1 week and maybe, you know, cannot trust his offensive line within a given game, it doesn't necessarily mean that 3 weeks down the road, the same thing is going to be the case.
I agree. If you look at a guy like Tannehill, now other quarterbacks, it might be different. But, I mean, if you look at a guy like Tannehill, that hasn't been the case. It always seems to be game by game, depending on how the game's going, as to whether he starts to get a little jittery or not in the pocket.
All right. Well, thanks a bunch, Ron, for coming on. And go ahead and take this time to plug any information about you that you want.
Really, you plugged it, but I'll go through it again. If you want to follow me on Twitter, definitely a great way to get me, at Finns Broadcaster, F-I-N-S Broadcaster. I got a couple of shows that I do. My own podcast is Unsquish the Fish. As Jets fans, I could recognize that saying, I'm sure. And if you also like to listen to me, Finnsiders, F-I-N-S Siders, Finnsiders Radio. We'll be back on here.
Isn't that PH?
Yeah, that's PH. Did I say F or PH?
I think you said F.
Okay, well, it's P-H-I-N, yeah, Finnsiders Radio. So just check me out on all those podcasts, and many times I'm on Finmaniacs Live, too, and I write for Finmaniacs. So I'm a huge Dolphins fan, and I just kind of dip a toe into everything, it seems.
Yeah, and Ron's a great follow on Twitter. You can constantly interact with him, and he was just telling me before he got on air that he was, you know, kind of trolling a Colts beat writer because the Colts beat writer said that Joe Philbin, the former Dolphins head coach, is going to improve the offensive line so much. So
yeah, I just saw the excitement from everybody's eyes, and I just wanted to say, like, oh God, you guys have no idea. But you know, I mean, and here's the thing too, is when Philbin was the offensive coordinator in name, like, he didn't actually do anything offensive coordinators do in Green Bay, but when he was, like, their offensive line was the worst. Rodgers was getting hammered all the time. Now there's a guy that could seem to play well even with a bad offensive line, honestly, because I remember 3-4 years ago, that was just a really bad offensive line in Green Bay, and it didn't seem to stop Rodgers from throwing up 40 touchdowns or whatever and 4,500 yards. But the line even was bad then. I just feel bad for Colts fans that if they're waiting for Joe Philbin to come save them. That's the only, so I had to mess with them a little bit, but it's still a good article either way.
Yeah. Even Ben Roethlisberger, he's another one. He's on this list 4 or 5 times over. And you think back, he won a Super Bowl in 2008, and they were constantly in playoff contention. So, you know, I think if the quarterback's mentally tough and they know what they're doing, I don't think that pressure is going to mentally wreck them to where they can't rebound. But anyway, thanks. I think this was an insightful conversation, and I appreciate you coming on, Ron.
Hey, thanks, man. Thanks for having me.
All right, so now I'm joined by Max Himmelrich of the Deep End Miami to talk about Christian Hackenberg. And you know what? Max is a Miami Dolphins fan, but he has a strong, strong opinion on Christian Hackenberg, and it's not one that Jets fans are going to want to hear. So, Max, let's get started. I asked you a couple of weeks ago now, why are you so down on Christian Hackenberg? To which you said a couple things. You said intangibles, accuracy, technique, pocket presence. It ain't good. And you started sending me some crying emojis. So I said, we should have you on and talk about this. So let's start off with the intangibles, all right? And before we get there, I want to play this for you.
If you go back to 2013, Bill O'Brien did compare some of the traits you have to those he also saw in Tom Brady.
What do you think about that? When you hear that, what goes through your mind?
I mean, it's a college coach's job to promote their recruits. That is how they get recruits. You get people drafted. And that's what Bill O'Brien was trying to do. And it's very nice. But I mean, if someone asked about Brian Hoyer's intangibles, I'm sure he would say the same thing. Do you think Tom Brady, if he lost the game, would blame Bill Belichick? Because Christian Hackenberg was blaming Penn State's head coach for his struggles.
Oh, yes, he certainly was. And
so do you think Tom Brady, can you imagine Tom Brady getting up there and saying, you know, Bill Belichick really didn't call great plays, none of the coaches really did their job, and I'm putting this loss on them?
I mean, him questioning Belichick, I mean, I don't think it's ever happened in 15-plus years.
Even an offense, even an assistant coach, even the ball boy. Can you imagine Tom Brady getting up there? I mean, like, a Patriots fan, they're going to blame anyone. It should be the ball boy. But if at this point, can you imagine Tom Brady doing anything like that? No, not even close.
I mean, the closest that we have seen is him getting to a shouting match with Bill O'Brien on the sideline. But other than that, I mean, that happens within
that's
the
different. You don't take that. That happens so frequently.
Yes, yeah, so we even saw your boy Tannehill doing that a little bit. Who did he do that with?
Like, if anyone had a reason to yell at a coach, it was Tannehill and Bill Lazor. Tannehill yelled at Bill Lazor because Tannehill got chastised for calling an audible, even though the audible resulted in the touchdown.
Yeah, and you know, this whole Christian Hackenberg, you know, he's like Tom Brady, he's such a heady quarterback, and we'll get more into that in a little bit. You know, we seem to hear that frequently. Actually, you know what, let me just go ahead and let me play another clip for you on that.
Okay.
Not to bury the lead here, but I love him as a prospect despite all of the ugly statistics. Mentally, he's an NFL quarterback. When you watch him at the line of scrimmage, you can still see the Bill O'Brien influences in him from his freshman year. You can still see why so many coaches are excited by him. He's a brain. Some college quarterbacks are track stars. Some are gunslingers. Christian Hackenberg is a brain. And that was apparent in the season opening game against Temple more than any other game this season.
I'm not sure if you're familiar with this clip, but that was from a piece that had like 72,000-plus YouTube views that Brett Coleman made on Christian Hackenberg. He's very high on him, and he compared him to, you know, Bill O'Brien, Tom Brady. He saw many of those same traits. I mean, this Tom Brady, Christian Hackenberg likeness, I mean, this is not just coming from one source. This is coming from many places. So this seems to be some kind of myth that's being spread around.
Look, you can prepare mentally however hard you want, but if you can't get the job done on game day, then it doesn't matter. I saw nothing that showed me that Christian Hackenberg is capable of executing physically to the level that Tom Brady is. Because knowing where to throw the ball is half the battle. The other half is getting it there. I did not see Christian Hackenberg do that. And, you know, let's address the elephant in the room here. And it's something that everyone tiptoes around. People don't talk about it. There's racism in the quarterback position. There's very clear racial bias in the quarterback position. You know, people who don't know football think Warren Moon was a running quarterback just because he was African-American. Warren Moon was one of the best pocket passers in NFL history. I mean, you look and here are Christian Hackenberg's assets. Let me read this from an NFL.com scouting page. Prototypical size for pocket quarterback. Durable and tough. Willing to hang in and take a hit. Like, that just sounds like Danny Woodhead. Like, I mean, that's what we're talking about here. Like, you're going to see it at the running back position, too, with Christian McCaffrey coming out in the draft this year. You're going to hear people say he's undersized, even though he's, like, 6'1", 215, 220. Like, it's amazing the bias that people have in these positions, especially wide receivers, another one. Let's call a spade a spade and say that this 6'4", 230-pound dude named Christian Hackenberg got drafted to try to be the franchise quarterback, you know, was playing golf at his country club when he got the call. Let's call the situation what it is.
He was actually playing some cornhole out in his backyard when he got the call.
Oh, I was watching the thing on NFL Network. He was playing the day before the draft. He was at the country club. They did a special on it.
Oh, man. Intangibles. Christian Hackenberg, the next Tom Brady. Man, us Jets fans, we got a lot to be happy for, a lot to be optimistic for.
I mean, like, you guys need the next Ryan Fitzpatrick first.
Oh, please. I'm not high on Fitzpatrick.
What is the state of
that
with Jets fans? Are Jets fans done? Have they resigned themselves? Because I choose not to associate myself with too many Jets fans.
I don't blame you. No, we're a rough bunch.
I have a couple good friends who are Jets fans, but I'm wondering from those who, like yourself, who really aggressively follow the NFL, what the stance is in Jets Nation.
I'll say this.
Because, like, if you look Hackenberg, I should say this. If you want to draft a project quarterback, I have no problem with Hackenberg in the fourth round. If they've taken Hackenberg in the fourth round and they had Fitzpatrick under contract, I would say it's fine because he's a developmental quarterback. He showed a lot of promise his freshman year. But the problem is he didn't get better. He got actively worse every year. So when you look at the situation, like, if he has to start, I mean, like, honestly, what are you getting out of Geno Smith? They know he's not the guy. No reason to put him out there. You're not a win-now team with Geno Smith. So are you a win-now team with Christian Hackenberg at the moment? No. But Christian Hackenberg could be the guy in a few years. And if there's anyone he should learn from about how to execute in an NFL offense, it's Ryan Fitzpatrick. Because Ryan Fitzpatrick knows his deficiencies, and he got in there and learned how to execute in the Jets system and did a beautiful job last season. Almost took them to the playoffs. They were, you know, a few completions away. So when you look at that situation, Christian Hackenberg is a guy who could be Ryan Fitzpatrick for 12 years. You know, 24-year-old, 25-year-old Christian Hackenberg could become Ryan Fitzpatrick in 2 years. And then you guys are in a really good place. The problem is if you play him now, you stand a chance to have the Kaepernick thing where the confidence just goes completely.
You seem to be higher on Fitzpatrick than I am, but I will agree with you in the sense that the biggest reason
in their system, outside of their system,
I hear you, because he only has really flourished in his career under Chan Gailey. His best years have come there, but that's the biggest reason. If I'm to find any reason why I would like the Jets to re-sign Ryan Fitzpatrick at the amount that they're trying to give him, or possibly even more than that, it would be to be a positive influence on Christian Hackenberg in his young career. And honestly, it's signing Fitzpatrick, and then if you also keep Geno on the roster too, it's all the more reason why we won't have to see Hackenberg potentially even step on the field this year, because you don't want him coming in under any circumstance this year.
I think relief is fine. I think I'm a believer that quarterbacks should get their feet wet. I mean, you saw the Dolphins plan Dan Marino's rookie year. I don't know. This is deep history for Jets fans that they might not be so aware of. Dan Marino didn't start for like 4 games. What happened was the Dolphins quarterback was playing poorly. I forget who the starter was at that point. Dolphins fans are going to be mad at me for that. But they had, on a few occasions, Dan Marino came in for relief, and then finally Dan Marino started. I think it was either week 4 or 5. So it's – you don't worry necessarily about those quarterbacks. You know, even if you throw an interception and, you know, if you go out there for 7 throws, it's good to get those reps. I mean, it'll be interesting. Hackenberg will definitely play a big role in the preseason. I don't even think you should send Geno Smith out there. Like, who cares? You know what Geno Smith is. Geno Smith's a quarterback with plenty of ability and no way to execute on it. And he's like almost like the anti-Hackenberg. Like, Geno Smith can get the ball there but doesn't know where to go with it. Hackenberg might know where to go with it but can't seem to get it there. I mean, there's like a compilation vine of like 8 throws that Hackenberg put straight into the dirt right out of the backfield, like slants and like swing routes by the running back, like things he literally like are like any quarterback can make blindfolded, and Hackenberg throws it straight into the dirt.
Not to mention those screen passes that sail 10 yards over the running back's head.
Oh yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing that he was still considered like a high level pro prospect.
You know, that Geno Hackenberg quote, that's definitely going to be one that I'm going to be posting on the Twitter machine. So thank you a lot
Geno
for that
Hackenberg.
One.
That name just scared me. That threw me off for a second.
And by the way, Max really, really dislikes Geno Smith in his play. So if you want to go back and listen to some comments that he had previously made about Geno Smith, then scroll back through our podcast feed and you can find the episode that has Max Kimmel-Rich. I think it's episode 47, if I can remember correctly.
One of the greatest storylines, I think something that'll be, you know, people who were a generation before ours always reference these like little NFL history nuggets that people closer to our age range would have no way of knowing. I feel like one of those for me is going to be when Geno Smith getting punched in the face added like 10 wins to the Jets record. Because I genuinely think that was still like, you know, like maybe a 6-10, 7-9 team with Geno Smith.
You know, I don't know if I totally, but listen, I do think that Fitzpatrick elevated the Jets' play, and he definitely got them maybe a win, two more wins, but I don't know about this whole four or five more wins.
Really?
That whole notion. Honestly, I really don't think Fitzpatrick was all too great last year. We had a guy on, I think it was the very next week after you, named Edward Gorelick, who does extensive work with the quarterbacks, and he had actually charted every single one of Ryan Fitzpatrick's throws, and he made some really detailed Excel sheets to which he said, you know, like, all right, Fitzpatrick, when he throws this route, you know, when he throws to this player, this is his quarterback rating, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, one of the things that he noticed when he charted is that the amount of interceptable balls that Fitzpatrick threw last year or could have thrown had they been picked off was 32 interceptable passes.
Wow.
Yeah, so it was really bad. And Brandon Marshall and Eric Decker repeatedly bailed him out. One thing, you know, listen, Geno Smith, your criticisms are totally valid. But one thing that you can't argue is Geno, he was throwing to guys like Clyde Gates, Stephen Hill. You know something about Clyde Gates being a Dolphins fan.
Clyde Gates.
I mean, David Nelson, these are his top receivers. Jeremy Curley. I mean, come on. These are his top receivers. So imagine if he has a healthy Eric Decker and Brandon Marshall. Could he have been better? It's hard to say that he couldn't have been.
You know what? I will say Dolphins fans make all these excuses for Ryan Tannehill. Because let's be real, I'm a fan of Tannehill. I like what he does, but Dolphins fans make excuses. And just because it's an excuse doesn't mean it isn't a valid excuse. And I think, you know, Geno Smith deserves that benefit of the doubt. So sure, I'll definitely admit, you know, when Ryan Fitzpatrick got there, that receiving corps got a lot better. And Brandon Marshall on tape had possibly it was definitely his most consistent year and probably his best.
Yeah, he was good every single week. Every single week.
On the Dolphins, he would take plays off. He was good, really, really good last season. And looking forward with the Jets and kind of back to Hackenberg, I really like what Todd Bowles did his first year in kind of becoming the anti-Rex. But right now, it just doesn't seem like there's a plan. And, like, my big question, you heard trade talks around some of the Jets players, and you have Sheldon Richardson suspended for, you know, probably 15 games fewer than he should have been for that incident. And you have Muhammad Wilkerson who needs a contract. It's a whole mess there. But do they really think that without Fitzpatrick and with Geno Smith or Christian Hackenberg, having one of those guys is really going to help them that much? Having Wilkerson in the big money deal? You need a quarterback. In the NFL, they don't grow on trees. You know, if you have a guy who can even just execute in your system, then that's good. And I think in 3 years, Hackenberg could be ready. You know, based on the rookie wage scale and the rookie contract, you don't get more than 3 years to be ready because your fourth year, you got to be playing. No one's going to sign you to an extension if you haven't played. So the Jets' timeline has to be 3 years. And what I would imagine is that the problem is that almost like what Dwayne Wade just went through at the Miami Heat, Fitzpatrick knows he's going to decline in year three, but he wants that year on the contract. He wants that year for security. And the Jets won't give it to him because they drafted Christian Hackenberg, too. They know, okay, we're going to need to get Hackenberg on the field at some point. They want Fitzpatrick for 2 years so they can bench him halfway through the 2017 season and play Hackenberg. But that's not what Fitzpatrick wants. He wants security.
Yeah, I mean, in all fairness, as far as I understand, the contract offer that is currently on the table for Fitzpatrick is pretty much the same thing that they offered him back in March, which is a good month before they even drafted Christian Hackenberg. So they've made a line in the sand of where their stance is with Fitzpatrick. They view him as an immediate bridge type of guy, and they're looking for the guy for the future, and they know it's not him. But let's stay on topic with Mr. Hackenberg, because I know that your time is very valuable, and I'm not going to have you that much longer. In staying with the whole idea of intangibles, you know, Skip Bayless would say this.
I got T-Bone. Oh, he shatters the mold, and all he does is win. All he does is win.
All right, now listen.
Oh, my God.
One thing that Hackenberg said when he sat down with Kimberly Jones is, hey, listen, all 3 years I was at Penn State, we had a winning record. And not only that, too, but you also have to think about it like this. After the sanctions had dropped in, you know, who was Christian Hackenberg, who did he have blocking for him? He had converted defensive linemen, right? He wasn't throwing to Allen Robinson in those latter 2 years. However, he still had a winning record. You know, so isn't there something to be said for that? I mean, doesn't he have the intangibles that he can win, Max? What would you say to that?
Wins are not a quarterback statistic. This isn't baseball. You can't count wins on one player. I mean, you can count singular games. One player can put a game on their back, mostly at the running back position, the easiest place to see it. But or defensive linemen, but at quarterback, there's so many moving pieces. And also, let's talk about Penn State's wins for a second. Did you watch a lot of Penn State's games?
I watched absolutely no Penn State games, other than when I watched them in replay, just watching Christian Hackenberg.
Right.
But
they were some of the most hideous college football games you'll ever see. I can't remember a good Penn State game. And who cares if they were beating up on Southern West Mississippi Valley State College? You know, because in college football, you get a 4-game head start because you play your non-conference games. So to have a winning record, you only really need to win like 5 games.
Yeah.
Did they beat any good teams? They got spanked by Michigan, I think.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
it's like good teams when they came in there knew how to beat Hackenberg, which is to make him throw the football, and then he ends up beating himself because he can't really do it very well. Like, strength. 6'4", 240 pounds, name is Christian Hackenberg. Weaknesses, throwing the football.
Quickly, let's hit on some of these other points that you brought up. Accuracy, technique, pocket presence. Let's try to do it quickly so we could get you out of here. Accuracy. I pulled this from a Pro Football Focus article in which they said Christian Hackenberg probably shouldn't even have a draftable grade. And it says, quote, even when under no pressure, because that's one of the big things that everyone says about Hackenberg. Well, the reason he was so bad is because he had defensive linemen blocking for him, and they were just absolutely horrible. But let me go on with the quote. Even when under no pressure at all this past season, he completed just 61.9% of his passes. That's the same completion percentage Cardale Jones managed on all plays, not just pressure plays. And Jones is a player whose accuracy is seen as a negative. So Hackenberg's completion percentage under no pressure, which is 61.9%, would have ranked 44th in the nation if it was his real completion percentage.
That's bad. I mean, it's the whole situation is pretty bad for Hackenberg in terms of accuracy. Like, we've seen it. I understand if a few plays get away from you in terms of screens, you know, if a couple plays get away from you, but it was weekly. And you would watch Hackenberg try to throw basic routes. He doesn't have that strong of an arm even. Because Cardale Jones, you look at the inaccuracy and you say, well, he could bomb it. Like, you know, you can do something with him. You can work with that. Hackenberg, it's like even if he becomes accurate, he doesn't have an incredibly strong arm.
Completely agree with you. Completely agree. Technique. So this is one of the things that you brought up. You see a lot of problems with this technique. It's something that I've seen as well. Could you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah, what I see a lot of is in his feet. You know, even because, and this is a product of being under pressure so much, he's jumpy, which is, like I said, understandable. But what he'll do is he'll be moving, and there'll be no pressure, and he'll still, for some reason, try to throw the ball without really setting his feet. You know, it's the equivalent in basketball of, like, taking a shot on the run for no reason. Like, he really could stand at times to just wait and set his feet. And that kind of works into pocket presence, because pocket presence and being willing to take a sack are totally different. Hackenberg is willing to take a hit, but he doesn't throw well with pressure in his face. He stands there and waits, but he doesn't play well when the pressure's in his face. Think about Ben Roethlisberger. When you watch him play, he waits until the defensive lineman's right there, right until he needs to throw it, and he can still place it well. Hackenberg can wait and can get the ball out, but there's no telling where it's going to go.
Don't remind me about Ben Roethlisberger, man. That guy gave us such fits in that AFC Championship game. We'd get to him, and we couldn't bring him down. He's such a pain in the ass. He is a really good quarterback. With the technique, I think this might be the most fixable thing. One thing that I noticed is, you know, he would always switch his feet, which foot is on, you know, his front foot, and which foot is his back foot, the right or left. And what I noticed during the one season is sometimes you even notice that he would take his first step back with the foot that was, you know, behind. And sometimes he would take his first step back with the foot that was in front. And it's like, what the heck? There's no consistency there. And it seemed that he was a little bit more inaccurate when he took his first step back with his front foot. I don't know if I picked up on something. It's not like I charted the thing after all. But it is something that I pointed out in the film session that I did with Edward Gorelick, which I'm going to post once this thing is done. But I don't know. The technique, you wonder if it's something – a lot of people say it's the change in coaching staff. He had good footwork when he had Bill O'Brien his freshman year, and then James Franklin came in and screwed everything up. That's the popular narrative, but you have to wonder.
Well, technique gets worse when your offensive line is bad. And so it could have permanently affected his technique, which you can work back from, but I think that's the most fixable thing. I think the accuracy is the seems like the least fixable thing because, like you said, even on unpressured plays, it was not great.
And, of course, you would know something about that being a Dolphins fan. It's not like Ryan Tannehill
has
had great protection.
I know all about quarterbacks under pressure.
All right, and last but not least, so you talked a little bit about pocket presence already. Again, this is one thing Brett Coleman in that video that I played for you the clip a little bit earlier. By the way, anyone that's listening to this that hasn't watched that, do yourself a favor. Go and watch that. You'll leave and you might get a little bit
– some of his YouTube – he does the YouTube videos where he kind of narrates them and runs film, right?
Yeah, and, you know, he likes to go into the X's and O's. Hey, listen, it's definitely very good quality production. You cannot take that away from that at all. But, you know, he brings up the Temple Christian Hackenberg game, which is the first game of the season of last year, and he looks at it as overall positive. And, you know, Christian Hackenberg only threw for 103 yards in that game. They lost 10 to 27 in that game. And he goes through and he says, you know, look at all the adjustments that Hackenberg is making against this pro-style type of defense that the Temple Owls employ. And, you know, but when you read the Pro Football Focus article, one of the big criticisms that they bring up is that, you know, Hackenberg, you know, he was only like pressure – he was pressuring – I'm trying to bring it up right here. Let's see. Hackenberg was under pressure on 17 of his 36 dropbacks, but they say that only 7 of those pressures were charged on the offensive line. Now, again, this is Pro Football Focus, and whatever statistics, I don't know exactly what they would consider a pressure. If you do go back and watch that film, the offensive line was getting beat like a drum. But there are certain times, too, when, again, he's under no pressure at all, and he's still – makes an errant pass. So that is something to definitely keep into consideration. And another thing that they cite, and this is something that I would have to agree with them, is Jared Goff had maybe just as bad as an offensive line, if not worse. However, he still had a pretty damn good season, and he looked pretty good. I don't know if you're high on him at all.
Goff? I'm pretty neutral on him.
Pretty neutral.
I think.
Okay.
If he and Deshaun Watson were coming out the same year, I think Watson would blow him out of the water.
Interesting point. Well, maybe if the Jets have to play Hackenberg this year, they'll be eligible to draft Watson next year. Yeah, that's one thing I keep saying.
That would make Dolphins fans' lives tough for a while.
Hey, you know what? Maybe if you guys have a bad season, maybe you'll get rid of Tannehill and draft Watson.
That's what I said. If Ryan Tannehill is bad enough that the Dolphins are ready to move on from him, after next season, it means that they won 4 games. So
I'll tell you what, though. I'll take Tannehill on the Jets. Not that I love him.
You guys would take Tannehill on the Jets in a heartbeat.
But you guys wouldn't want to take Fitzpatrick,
though. A lot of teams would take Tannehill. Broncos would take him in a heartbeat. Texans would take him in a heartbeat. Browns would take him in a heartbeat. There's
absolutely
a lot of teams that would take Ryan Tannehill.
All right, so Max, go ahead and plug all your information.
Yeah, we've got on Twitter, you can follow our site at the Deep End Miami, me at Himmelrich NFL, and we post a lot of X's and O's analysis for the Dolphins, and it's good stuff for any football fan, really, highly educational. We love doing it, and feel free if you have any questions or hatred to direct towards me to do it on Twitter.
Absolutely. And Max, I don't know how you could forget, but you just launched your podcast, the Deep End Miami podcast.
Yes, we did. If you like the Deep End Miami on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at the Deep End Miami, you'll definitely be getting updates on that. And for Miami Dolphins and Miami Heat talk, you can follow us over there.
So you also will be doing on every episode, it's Dolphins and Heat talk, just so I'm clear.
Well, situationally, we'll do some Dolphins. We'll do some Dolphins at this time of year, but not really, because obviously there's some substantial things going on in the universe right now, but some substantial and emotional things. But during the season, you know, in October, when there's not really much going on for basketball, I doubt we'll touch on the Heat.
Fair enough. And guys, I say this, and I'm not just because he's joining me right now, but one of the reasons I really wanted to have him on is Max does some really good stuff. We had him on a couple episodes ago to talk about this Ryan Tannehill piece that he wrote, fact or fiction styled piece, where he went through and said, you know, is it fact or is it fiction that Ryan Tannehill can't throw the deep ball? Really, really good article. He does good stuff. Lots of his articles have moving images, GIF images. You really owe it to yourself to follow him on Twitter, check him out, and check out his podcast for that matter, because it just launched, and I enjoyed the first episode very much. So I know you guys are audio listeners. Otherwise, you wouldn't be listening to this show. So go ahead and give his show a listen. Max, I want to thank you so much for joining me and expressing how much you dislike Christian Hackenberg and his potential. Thank you. I needed a negative
slant. Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Had fun joining you.
Take care.
All right, so let's wrap this baby up. But before I give my concluding thoughts on Mr. Christian Hackenberg, I want to tell you that we did a film room for this podcast, and I was actually going to edit the audio of that film room and put it right at the very tail end of this podcast. However, what that would do is that would add about 2 hours worth of audio to this podcast. That would make it a bigger file to download. Some of you guys that might have like a 16 gig iPhone or whatever, it's going to be a really large podcast file and thus a pain to download to your phone. So I decided that I'm not going to add the audio of that in this podcast. Instead, I'm just going to direct you to where you can watch it. I'm going to put the link for that in the description of this, as well as I will tell you that you can go to our YouTube channel, AFC East Bros, Christian Hackenberg Film Room, and you can find it. Again, I will be plugging that link in the description of this. And a gentleman by the name of Edward Gorelick, who actually came on AFC East Bros before to discuss Ryan Fitzpatrick, and he did this really interesting segment where he broke down all of Fitzpatrick's throws. He charted every single one of them, and he has QB ratings on how good he was on this throw, how good he was on that throw, etc. So he's done extensive work on quarterbacks, and he came in and he did a film breakdown of Geno Smith, and where he made these huge threads on Twitter, the 2013 all Geno's throws, 2014 all Geno's throws, and you can go find them. They're pinned, I believe, to his profile on Twitter at Edward Gorelick, Gorelick. So he's done extensive work with quarterbacks. So I decided to have him come on and discuss Christian Hackenberg. And he's also done film breakdown of Hackenberg, in which he's done a bunch of clips. So what I did is I took a bunch of the clips that he did, and I put them all into one thing, and then we made a YouTube video where we were going over every single one of those clips. So you should really, really check it out. If you listened to this whole podcast, 2+ hours just about the man Christian Hackenberg, you owe it to yourself to watch that. You really owe it to yourself to watch that. Again, if you listen to this entire podcast in which I had Dolphins fans on, two different Dolphins fans, and you heard me, I'm not the most optimistic person about Christian Hackenberg. If you were willing to listen to all that, then you should watch this film breakdown of him. Again, I'll be posting that. Now, what are my concluding thoughts on Mr. Christian Hackenberg? Well, I think the Jets are taking the right approach in letting him sit, despite the fact that he's ran pro-style concepts, played and started all 3 years in college football. You know, it seems like, at least on some surface level to some people, that he might be ready for the NFL, at least in terms of a mental aspect, more so than some certain other guys that come in. Like, for example, Marcus Mariota last year didn't run too many NFL pro-style concepts, yet he was still starting from day one. Seems like mentally he'd be more ready than him. But I think the Jets are taking the right approach in letting him sit, because at the very least, even if getting pummeled hasn't destroyed him, he's at least had to lose some of that confidence. And if you remember back when I was talking about the Bleacher Report article, he was that young kid, you know, barking out all Tom Brady's calls and what he's going to do on this next play and that play. I think part of that kid eroded. Now, that's not to say that that can't come back, but he needs to regain some of that confidence. So I think that the Jets letting him sit are taking the right approach. Now, with that being said, I don't have high expectations for Christian Hackenberg. You will see in the film breakdown that I did with Edward Gorelick, we were kind of raving about some of his traits and thinking that some of it's fixable and thinking that he's got enough raw talent that he could maybe work. I think overall, we highlighted a lot of the positives in that. But overall, if I had to side more on one person's side, I would probably be more towards Max, where I'm more down on the guy. I'm not overly optimistic that he's the answer for the future. If you follow me and you follow me on Twitter, when the Jets selected him 51st overall, I was pissed. Mackenzie Alexander still on the board. The Jets could certainly use another nice young quarterback. I did not think Christian Hackenberg was the answer. And I did want a quarterback. I wanted Jared Goff. I was willing to trade up for Jared Goff. That didn't happen. But even that we sat and didn't have to trade up and we got Hackenberg in the second, I still wasn't happy. So I haven't been happy with the guy or very optimistic since day one. And even though I've since went through and watched every single one of his throws on Draft Breakdown, I've done this extensive work and research and looked at all his analytics. I've had a film breakdown session with Edward Gorelick. I've spoken to a bunch of other people. It hasn't made me too much more optimistic. I will say there's a chance with the kid. There is a chance. I'm not going to totally, and I do like him as a person, but I just don't know that you can fix some of those accuracy issues. I don't know if you can all of a sudden overnight make yourself become much more accurate. And I think that Christian Hackenberg, despite the fact that he's got a pretty good arm, I just think he's way too inaccurate to be successful in the NFL when windows are so small and you need to be so precise with your throws. I just don't know if he can do it. If he were to come in this year, I think that Brandon Marshall and Eric Decker would help him out, being that they have good catch radiuses, but it's not the year for him anyway, and who knows where they'll be a year from now. So anyway, I'm more down on the guy. You can call me a doubter, you can call me a hater, you can call me whatever you want, but I'm not overly optimistic. I don't think at this point in time that he is the Jets' future franchise quarterback. Thank you so much for Ron Caniff, for Max Himmelrich, and for Edward Gorelick for helping contribute to this piece. Really appreciate your guys' time. I hope that I can produce some more non-live shows like this. And please let me know what you think. Interact with me on Twitter at AFC East Bros. My brother's AFC underscore East Bro Gary. You can email the show afceastbros@gmail.com. If you're listening to this for the first time because you have some interest in Christian Hackenberg, but you really don't care much for the AFC East, maybe you're a Penn State fan, or maybe you're just finding us for the first time. My brother Gary, who is a Buffalo Bills fan, and I, New York Jets fan, we try to be as unbiased as possible. Try, keyword. And we do a live show every Tuesday evening from 6 Eastern Standard Time to 8 Eastern Standard Time about the AFC East. Jets, Dolphins, Bills, Patriots, week in, week out. And we accept calls. The number to call in is 712-451-0011. The PIN number is 321-848. We love hearing from you guys. We love interacting. It makes it so fun. But in addition to those live shows, I'm going to try to do more of these non-live shows. So again, let me know what you think. And this is Kyle, the AFC East Bros. Until next time, I am signing off.